What is up? This is episode 300. Can you guys believe this? Movie Schmovie 300. Insanity. It's happening right now.
And Bono, 10 years.
For you 10 guys. Years. Literally to the week.
Yeah.
Like May 18th, really? 2011. Me, nice. Ronald, your basement, shit went down. That's what episode one, down. Insidious. Remember this?
I did John, not like that movie.
John, episode 39.
39.
On board.
Dark Knight
part
Rises.
Part of the crew, rolling deep with John Walker. And we are here right now.
You know how I found out that I was a permanent fixture on the show? The second episode you guys came over here to do, we did The Dark Knight Rises, and then you guys came over here to do another one. And when you introduced me for the second episode, Ronald said, and he is Permanente.
Permanente.
And I remember we both looked at him for a second, Steve. We both were like, oh, okay. Well, we're okay. It's been decided. I don't think we ever discussed it outside of that, really. Or
really?
It's just like,
the whole.
I mean, I think maybe you said, would you like to do more? And I said, anytime. But it still was this question of like, are we literally now saying this is the plan every week? You know, and then, and then a beautiful thing.
All
began.
To just find out today, John is basically here to tell us that he never wanted to be on the podcast.
Right.
The
yeah.
He just didn't want conflict and he just wanted to be very nice. And John, we thank you for coming on board and upping the game from that point forward. Man, I can't believe it.
I know.
10 years, man.
It's pretty special, man. I've loved doing this podcast with you guys.
It's a lot of fun. And
yeah,
it's the last year for all the shit that has come and hit the fan, and you know, everybody's gone through so many challenges, everything like it, silver linings. We talk about them on the podcast still all the time. We try to find them, but for sure, one of them is the podcast has gone basically every week for the entire last year. And with a couple, you know, spots here and there, but we're averaging basically a podcast a week, which is something I don't know that we ever did as consistently before the pandemic hit.
We were weekly for a while, but never, I don't think, as regularly as this. Like, we've maybe had one or two little stops in that time where we went more than a week really without a new episode. So it's just
amazing, you know. And I think that it's kind of given us opportunity to do episodes on things that we never got to do before, you know, like kind of going through these series of these franchises that, you know, the watch them all idea is, you know, something we've always talked about. And we did a little bit, we did a couple series here and there, but like, we've been able to do it more in the last year. And we're in the middle of, you know, doing the Nightmare on Elm Street one right now. You know, we've been doing the Marvel Schmarvel spinoff on YouTube as an exclusive, you know, when the Marvel properties are coming out on Disney Plus or in theaters, anything like that. It's just been a really fun year and a fun decade, and crazy that we've done 300 episodes of something that basically started in the back of house at an Apple store. And you know, went from there to Ronald's basement, then to my bedroom, and then to John's basement, and now to each of our respective homes digitally over Zoom. But you know, soon enough, hopefully we'll be able to get back in some sort of, you know, same space recording situation and, you know, celebrate that as well. But right now, episode 300, amazing. Guys, I love you. Thank you for doing this with me.
Yes, I love you guys too. And it's like, you guys, it sneaks up on you when you do something long enough, and people that go from like people you know to people you hang out with to people that you really think are friends to then you start realizing that's like a high point of your week.
Yeah, and definitely.
Especially during this time, it's like, not only is this a high point, this has been, you guys have been my major social outlet really through this, because I've had other people have kind of come in and out. We've had little things we've done to try to touch base, and projects and everything have happened. But
this is
the only regular hang that's even on my calendar, honestly.
Yeah.
And it's to the point where when it's not happening, or for whatever reason we're not sure, I start to get that, like, I get a little antsy, like what are Ronald and Steve going to think of this? And I hope I'm not the only one who feels this way or whatever, you know. It's something that's on my mind. And really what's great is it does allow me to kind of like hit eject if I realize I'm about to bore the shit out of my wife talking to her about some movie that's coming out or something that I've rewatched or whatever.
Right.
I realize like, oh, there's a couple of guys who at least politely feign interest rather than my wife who just rolls her eyes audibly. You know, they make a scraping sound. She does it so hard. Yeah. But no, it's awesome. This is great to have an outlet. Everyone should have an outlet like this.
And go ahead, Ronald.
I was thinking, you know, this is with the pandemic and everything, it was something that could have destroyed our situation, you know, to be completely honest. But in the words of Dirty Dancing, nobody puts baby in the corner. And we made a situation even better. Like, you know, we've done festivals, we've covered things that we you know, thank you to some of the networks that have shared their content with us. We've gotten into this
interviews
situation. Yeah, and the interviews. We interviewed fucking Jonathan Tucker. By the way, I'm watching Snowfall now.
Oh yeah. He's so, so good. He's so good in that show.
Yeah, so we covered things that I never thought we'd ever cover, and you know, I would not want to do it with anybody besides you guys. Like, it makes me so happy when we do something new, something that challenges us. That's the best part about life, is your reaction to okay, so the only thing that really separates a good person from an asshole is their reaction to change, their reaction to inconvenience. And you know, we've been inconvenienced quite a bit during this pandemic, and we made the best of it. So
yeah, for sure.
I would even say we've weathered those few times. There's been a point where, like you said, like it got a little more difficult, or schedules were conflicting, or life was doing something, and we, you know, this could have, I mean, you know, I joke all the time that like the only reason that you keep doing something is because no one's stopping you. And like, you know, you like, this is something we're doing on our own cognizance. So it's like, nobody's asking us, nobody's making it. It's like the engine is us, right? But like, you know, the things that don't mean shit to you, they fall by the wayside. Relationships, projects, whatever it is, interests, they fall by the wayside. So when you look back on, you know, a decade and say like, why has this stayed with me? It's like, okay, because it adds something to my life. It means something to me. And you know, I love the idea that listeners or viewers now are getting something out of it too. But honestly, I mean, people out there may have been able to tell, it really doesn't, this is the same whether there's three people listening or whether there's 300 people listening or 3,000 or whatever. And I think that is the thing that might be what makes this, special. So, I mean, I just love that I have two men in my life who, kind of are like good influences, and it's like it's positive. It's just I don't know. You guys, I mean, I'm sure it sounds like you might know, but I'll tell you, I don't know that anybody can know how much I treasure this, this thing that we have. So,
yeah, it's great. It's great. And it's something that, you know, when we look back over the last 10 years, you know, we've all kind of come and gone from certain jobs. You know, we bought house. Some of us bought houses. Your son is now a teenager, John. I have two kids. Yeah. Ronald, you're married. I'm married. We have a house. Like, so much has happened to us personally that we've been able to share with one another and talk about on this podcast. And, you know, really kind of what started the podcast was that connection that we had at the Apple Store and just talking about movies all the time. And just really, like John was saying, knowing that, like, there's a person that I love talking with this about that I have the privilege of talking to weekly about. So, and that's something that, you know, among all the adversity and challenges and even the successes and the celebrations that we've had, you know, on some sort of regular schedule for 10 years and 300 episodes, really more, I guess, than 300 episodes. We've had some 0.5s. You know, it's just the idea that that's been that consistent and over 10 years in, and in some cases, one of the most consistent things in our lives is just something we should all celebrate. And I'm glad we're getting together to do that together today. And, you know, the idea for the episode, beyond us talking amongst ourselves, looking back over, you know, the last 10 years and thinking about what our singular choice is for like the best movie, best TV show, best piece of entertainment that we've had over the last 10 years. You know, John had this great idea to have some of our past guests on, you know, so we reached out, we got everybody scheduled up. Everybody was so kind to dedicate 15, 20 minutes of their time. Everybody's lives are busy. So thank you to everyone who we are going to have on the show. You'll see them here shortly, but past guests, you know, filmmakers, personal friends, you know, past employee, coworkers, and that became friends just like we are now.
A boss, someone who worked over us, actually, who kind of brought us together in a strange way. He was like nudging us towards each other.
But he had that special thing where he was never like, he never really felt like a boss.
I only say that because it's kind of funny.
He has something special. It is. You're right. You're right. But yeah, it's a great approach to celebrating something is to bring in the people that have shared it with us in some sort of frequency over the last 10 years. So it'll be really fun, and we're going to get them in here shortly, but we'll probably talk about our picks at the end of the show, but because we're pretty excited to get everybody. We have people waiting in a Zoom waiting room right now, but we're going to kind of get them on here. Do you guys have anything else you want to mention real quick or say before we bring our first friend of the pod on, and then we'll jump into that?
Just that I'm John.
I'm Steve.
I'm Ron.
And there you go.
Yeah, it is. And this right here coming into the episode is our first guest. Let's go. Look at
Let's
this.
Let's do this.
Hey, there he is.
Hey.
Hey now.
What's up, man?
What up? Man, what up?
Jason takes Manhattan in the background. I love it.
Yeah, man. This is my like pride and joy. Like if the house is burning, you know how like when the like if the house is burning down, you got those five things you're grabbing. Like this is one of them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I feel like you mentioned that like poster when you were on the podcast a while ago. So it's nice to see that bad boy.
Yeah, this is in my office now. So
nice, man.
Okay. Yeah. How are you? How's everyone?
Pretty good.
Yeah, man.
I'm good. Good, man. Your hair looks fucking incredible. Like,
thank you.
It's illustrious. It's
your hair looks gone.
Yeah, that's what that's called.
No. I said before we started this nice skull because that's what you're really complimenting when you say that to somebody. Yeah. It's like good head.
You have a
shape,
nice shape of your skull.
Like, oh, dude, I am so fucking terrified of going bald because I've got a bad head, bro. I got a bad head, man.
Look at this cereal box here. It's like thin and tall. Yeah, I'm gonna look like an Easter Island head when it all goes.
Oh, yours is not going anywhere, man. You're gonna be like one of those 90-year-old guys with like a full head of hair. And then I'm going to put the pillow over your face because I'm going to be mad at you.
Put you out of your misery.
I just like having a fan, you know, even if I'm laying there in a bed and I've been hobbled and things are turning for the worse. It's like, it's just nice to be appreciated. Someone out there.
Yeah.
Even if he's going to kill you.
Yeah.
I'm just glad that John is still in his spooky, like haunted, like basement.
Yeah, I know. Isn't this? Yeah.
He never comes out of there. It's just the constant.
No, they don't let me out. You mean.
Yeah.
We have a door now that's big enough to slide a little metal tray with like, you know, bread and beans and stuff on it. So I'm pretty
good. Good. I'm glad bread and beans is what fuels you.
Yeah.
So Brandon, I looked when you were last on the show, it was episode 165. This was June 27th, 2016, and you were on talking about your short film at the time, and I believe the topic we covered was at the time Conjuring 2 was a recent movie, and we were talking about kind of the modern state of horror. And I know that you were I can see from the posters in the background maybe you still identify as a horror filmmaker or a horror buff, but I know that your short that you were on the show to talk about was a horror short, so I don't know, maybe catch us up a little bit with what's been happening since the, you know, just recap the last 6 years if you can quickly.
Yeah, I have that down into like 15 words or less. Yeah, so moved to LA, hated it, came back to Baltimore, started a film production company, produced 15 or so movies since then. A lot of them horror. I have not directed since the back page officially. I ghost directed a movie. I'm not allowed to say which movie I actually ghost directed because someone else is named as the director, but they didn't do anything. Oh, wow. I did ghost direct a movie, but which sometimes you got to do as a producer. The movie needs to get made. But no, I've produced like 15 movies. I just worked on a film called Strawberry Mansion, which was fortunate enough to get into Sundance, which is like fantastic. It mostly because it like ruined like a whole like Christmas of my life to make that movie. And so at the time when I was making it, I was like, oh my God, what am I doing here for like the money and like the time at Christmas? And now it's in Sundance. So I'm like, yeah, I'll ruin every fucking Christmas if I can get into Sundance.
Yeah. Hell yeah.
Like I'll ruin them all. I'll ruin Christmas. I'll ruin Kwanzaa. I'll ruin them all to get into more Sundances. So, but yeah.
Congratulations on that, man.
Yeah.
Thank you.
That's great.
Yeah. Cool. So yeah. Film production company still going great. Commercials, narrative films, very fortunate. The whole thing is, and my entire career is built on the back of the back page, which is just a dumb 30-minute horror film that I self-produced a number of years ago. So moral of the story, if you have listeners who want to be a filmmaker, go for it. Because if you have enough willpower and you have enough like drive and talent, you can actually do it.
It's awesome, man.
Last time I was on this show, I was a mailman. And now I make a living. I make a better living as a filmmaker than I did last time I was on this show.
So you're saying that you owe your career to Movie Schmovie. That's what I heard, right, guys? I mean, we're all clear on that.
Yes, absolutely.
Cool. Awesome. Well, I mean, go us. Hey, yeah, Ronald, Steve, congratulations. Yeah. We did.
Your career.
We influenced somebody.
You're not getting any. You're not going to get any points on my. I'll give you my net grosses, but I'll send you a Christmas card next year.
That's great. Awesome. That's really awesome. Good, something physical is just great to see these days. But also, you know, one of the questions, the big question of the moment for you is, this is our 10th anniversary episode. We're thinking about, I mean, it's hard to think about a decade of movies, but yeah, so it's a sort of a deliberately impossible question. What is your favorite? And since we talk about television shows on this, we kind of expanded it to say movie or television show, but like your favorite kind of, you know, filmed narrative of the last 10 years. And there's no way that can be a true answer, but something is going to feel right. So I'd love to hear what you have to say about that.
Yeah. So I'm going to my notes. I have notes. So I came up with a short list. These are things that would be on it, but I don't know. But like once I narrowed it all down, I have my choice. So short list would be Midnight in Paris, Mad Max Fury Road, La La Land, Midsommar, and Mission Impossible Fallout. I think those are all amazing movies of the last 10 years.
Absolutely.
For all different reasons. But my favorite film of the last 10 years and something that blew me away when I first saw it and continues to blow me away every time I see it is Green Room.
Oh, wow. Oh, yeah, that's so a great good. Pick.
Yeah.
Unanimously across the board. Yeah. It's great.
Yeah. Yeah. Love this movie.
Brandon has good taste. Did
he
you
does. He does.
That's
yeah.
weird.
I do. Okay. I do. Pay no attention to the...
Hang on. Just block it out.
I've got a great taste.
Yeah. Yes. Got a great taste.
Yeah. So... Do you want me to talk about it?
Yeah, yeah. Tell us why. We are all fans of the movie, please. But what made it jump ahead of the pack for you?
Okay, so personally, for me, subjectively speaking, I think the movie really hit home to me because, like, and I know Steve, you might feel the same way. Is that like I came from a music background before, like I did any of the filmmaking. I think like I have never seen a movie about like. Independent musicians that nailed the feeling of like rolling up in your van to a show, to a town that you know nothing about. No one gives one fuck about you.
Yep.
Your show got canceled the day before. you literally are, you, all you need is like enough money to get you to the next show and gas money.
Right.
So like, this is like, just like, fuck it. Let's just play this skinhead bar. To just like get enough money to get home, like the uneasy feelings of like it's just me and my band against the entire world. They nail it. And like, so for me immediately, I fell in love with the movie before it like even like started pretty much, because I've just never seen a movie that just felt like what it's actually like to be in a band with people, like, you know, where you don't really get along and like, you know, but you kind of all you have is each other. Love it. Yeah. And just like, there's like, it nailed the fact, like the feeling of like rolling your equipment into like the bar, the venue for the first time. And everyone's kind of looking at you like, oh, there's that out of town band. Like, wonder what they're going to sound like. They're probably a bunch of assholes. Like just the feeling and like in your head, you're the musician. You're just like, look at these fucking schmucks. I can't wait until they see me take the stage and they know what this is about. Like, you know, like that's they had that swagger when they walked in. They knew that the crowd was going to like, you know, I loved it. So, subjectively speaking, the movie hit me like, ton of bricks that way. But objectively speaking, like, I think it's a fantastic movie. It's probably it's beautifully shot. It has fantastic performances, shot on like such a tiny shoestring budget. I think that movie was like less than 5 million. I don't know how they got Patrick Stewart to be in the movie, let alone Patrick Stewart to be in this movie playing like a skinhead Nazi. He's absolutely amazing. Who doesn't want to watch Nazis like get fucked up too? Like this is, I had a movie marathon at my house, for Halloween with some close friends. And, I put Green Room on the like playlist, and like no one had seen the movie before. Wow. besides myself. And like, it's such an easy, I realized, like, you know, you have friends over who haven't seen a movie, who knows if they're all gonna like it. It's such an easily digestible film to get into, because it's so easy to root against Nazis. Like,
oh my god, like, so true.
Yeah.
And like the first 5 minutes, whatever it is of the movie, does this great job, like a Pixar level job of what you just described, setting up the band dynamic, setting up the rolling into the unfamiliar situation, setting up the aimless day of waiting between shows, finding out a show is canceled. We're going to pick something up. We're in a town. We don't, you know, like you said, we're only here because one guy said, come here. It's like, no, all of that. And you said it, it's the, we don't always get along, but when outsiders come around, we are a unit, you know, it's us against them, but when it's just us, it's us against us. I think that's a great setup for a story for sure. So
exactly. Cause there was internal like issues, but at the end of the day, like the band sets those things aside to fight the external issues.
Yeah.
Which I love.
You were so much scarier in the dark. I mean, come on.
God, that's a great line.
Yeah.
Such a great line. Yeah. And I guess I didn't even talk of Anton Yelchin. I feel like it's his best performance.
Agreed.
And which is so like heartbreaking that like this was a guy who was coming into his own. I think he's like a guy who like Hollywood tried to like make as like kind of like a young like DiCaprio leading man who knows where he could go. He's not that. He's a character actor. I think he's fucking fantastic in this movie. And like, I wish that he was still here, because I think like the Green Room and some of his other last like late performances were really showing that this guy was going to take off and like do great things.
Yeah.
You know?
That's really sad.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was going to say that, I haven't been in a band, but I have been in areas that felt incredibly unsafe, and, mm-hmm. It reminds me of the Warriors. If the Warriors took place in one place, you know, that sense of like, I have to make it from point A to point B, but everybody between those two places wants to kill me.
Yeah,
is such a urgent, but I don't think the Warriors got to the urgency quite as quickly. And this did it in a way that my heart was racing the whole film. I was like, man, these guys are, somebody's going to die.
Yeah.
When I had that, like my movie marathon, and I was just like, all right, I hope my friends like this. Yeah. It was like, you could hear a pin drop in the room during the entire film. Everyone's like, I got to watch like a room full of people, like experience the heart attack that I experienced the first time I saw Green Room alone, which was just like, oh my God, what is going to happen? Are these dogs really going to do this? Or is this really going to be this brutal? Who's going to get out of this, you know, and how? Like, such, it's a heart attack of a film. So
yeah.
Well, it's a great pick, Brandon. And, you know, obviously there's so much we could talk about. Maybe we'll have Ren back. We'll have you back for a whole episode at some point.
Please, please do. So, I want to come back. As obviously I can talk about anything for an extended amount of time.
Well, seriously, thanks for making time for this, and thanks for picking such a great movie. I watched that again recently with my family. Neither my son's 13, my wife had never seen it, and it was like you said, I just kind of knew like this is a safe bet, you know.
Yeah.
Well, congratulations to you guys for you know hitting this milestone. Like this is, you know, most podcasts don't make it past like 12.
So, thanks, man. Yeah. It's funny, like the pandemic has like kind of refueled everything. Like we've been pumping out episodes every week. We got here sooner than we thought we would. So it's a really exciting time to be at 300. And thank you for sure for coming back. And congratulations on the production company and all that you've done in 5 years, basically. It's ridiculous, man. It's amazing. So keep it up, man.
Yeah.
Thank you.
All right, man.
All right. Take care.
Talk soon. Take care, guy.
You too. All right.
That's good seeing Brandon, man. It's been a while, man. I see him posting all the time about the stuff he's working on, and all of it looks really interesting.
Good.
I had to follow up with him. I don't really know how to see any of it. I tried to see the one he mentioned at Sundance when we were I was gonna mention that to him, but I didn't. But when we were doing the Sundance thing, I tried to get tickets to that premiere he had, the Strawberry, Strawberry Mansion or whatever the title of that was.
Booked up immediately.
It was gone. Yeah, it was instantly gone. Sold out. Yeah. So, and Sundance didn't do what South By did, where, you know, they had like the unlimited kind of thing. So, yeah, we should follow up with him, man. We should find out how we can see some of the stuff he's been pumping out and maybe talk about it on the pod at a future episode.
Well, guess who's waiting in the waiting room? Our next guest.
That is... There he is.
There's his name. Are we going to get
his video? Name with no spaces?
No, Mike. Michael Finazzo.
Hey! There he is.
Hey, Finazzo.
Obviously Mike in some Finazzo. Kind of storage room.
Are you
are
moving?
You kept in there, Michael?
No, this is my daughter's taking a nap. And oh. I told my wife that I told Laura, I was like, I have to go to the basement. And she's like, why? And I was like, because I have to do a podcast. And yeah, I don't want to wake my daughter up. So I'm staying out of my office, which is next door to her nursery. So it's so nice to see your faces, guys.
Yeah, same with you.
You too, man.
Yeah, how's everybody doing? Congratulations, by the way.
Thanks, man. Thank you.
Phone.
Yeah.
Congratulations to you too. Speaking of your daughter, I mean, speaking of beautiful faces, like your baby is adorable, man.
I know. And your photography takes after Laura, amazing as well.
She's gorgeous.
Yeah, she's got the advantage of like a filmmaker father to make it seem like this is just the most perfect kid ever.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, it's funny when I get pictures of nieces and nephews that are
shitty,
a little
like bad
more unfortunate looking and, you know, maybe out of focus. And I'm like, oh, that's nice. But yeah, no, it's one of those things too, where I know my daughter is really cute. And when people say it, I'm just like, yeah, she is. Yeah, thanks. Exactly. I feel like I should be like humble. And if anybody says anything positive about me, I'm just like, oh no, you don't have to say that.
Right.
When they say something about her, I'm like, yeah, she's perfect. Yeah.
Well, my wife and I used to say like, oh, we're so lucky. He got like all of our features that we wanted him to get and none of the ones we didn't want him to get. But what we don't say between us, but we both know is what we mean is he looks just like you, Nikki.
Yeah. We are lucky that we have attractive wives, John.
Yeah. Our fathers, everyone took us aside and said the gene pool is, you know, thank you so much.
That's funny.
At any rate, well, you know, I made a note the last time you were on the show. You've been on twice with us. You were on in 2016, April 30th on episode 160 to talk about films about artists. And I believe that was in reference to you had your movie Wit's End with starring Jason Weems. That was our basis for that. And then you were on again in 2018 to talk about Born in the USA, the movie you made that I provided the score to. But that was also to talk about Slice of Life films. And that was in June of 18. So yeah, I guess, you know, tell us what the last 2.5 years, I have a feeling I know what some of that is, but yeah, sounds like the kid and COVID and everything might've filled that time, but what's it been like for you since 18?
I was thinking, cause one of the last like social things I did, John, was I went over your house and hung out till like 4 o'clock in the morning and we recorded podcasts that no one ever heard.
Those are still coming, haven't that podcast got put on hiatus because I needed to bank a bunch of episodes and then the bottom fell out and people don't come to houses to record podcasts anymore.
Because I think it was like, would you remember when was that? Because I think it was like February or something, or it was like right before it all hit.
Yeah,
because it was like really nice, and it was like I always love it when we hang out anyway, and it was you were one of the last people I saw.
Same with these guys. I feel like you were over here recording an episode within like, you know, a short period before, but you realize now that seems like a long time ago. Like, what's it going to be like people start tromping around in your house again?
So crazy,
It's nuts, guys. And I listen to the show. I don't want to brag, you know.
Thanks,
but you're the only local podcast I listen to, so you're rarefied air. And one of them in the early parts of COVID, Ronald said that if anyone came up to him or close to him not wearing a mask, he was going to kick them in the face. And that's a sentiment that I relate to and have spent the last, you know, 14 months or whatever it's been feeling. I feel like because I have to go to work sometimes now, and I saw somebody like wearing a mask with their nose popping out, which is one of my peeves, and I acted like they were like from The Walking Dead or something. it is so weird.
You put a screwdriver like suspiciously easily into their head and then they fell down.
It's just weird that like this kind of stuff like on Zoom used to be so weird for me and uncomfortable for all of us.
Right.
And
definitely.
Now this is normal and seeing people is like fucked up. I don't know.
So true. That's so crazy. True.
But you know the last, go ahead, Ronald.
Weird to think about, man. You did Wit's End. Jason Weems had that crazy situation with like almost passing away in Pennsylvania. And I like, I did his return show when he did a show with Pierre in Exit the Apple Art Space. And then I rewatched Wit's End, and that movie like hit me like a ton of bricks, man. Seeing him in motion, because he's well now, but like, God, that was a crazy situation.
And yeah, that was weird. No, sorry. This is the unfortunate thing about Zoom too, is I'm going to interrupt all of you individually.
It's welcome.
But yeah, so the Weems thing, right before he had his medical stuff, we filmed his little part for Born in the USA. And we were still filming while he was dealing with that stuff. But yeah, so I was one of the people that helped track down his wife in the middle of the night when that was all happening. Yeah. Just because no one could get a hold of her. And finally, like, I got a hold of his friend Brian, who lived nearby, and he went and knocked on our door. But it was weird because then, like, so it wasn't that first show, but I ended up opening for him somewhere, and we carpooled. And it was weird to have us fill in each other, but fill in parts we didn't know about what happened.
Yeah, and that story.
Night. Yeah, because like, he was telling me, like, stuff that I just never had any contact of or anything. And he knew I got a hold of his wife and talked to her on the phone eventually, but he didn't know how we were all trying to like track people down. It was me and Russ Green and Haywood, who I know you know, Ronald. And so it was weird to be like on that side of it too, and to see him since then and talk to him since then. It is, everything is in a different light. It is really strange.
You helped save his life, okay, man. You help save his life.
I'm not going that far, but it's just weird to.
I'm going to tell everybody that you came on here and said you're a hero for saving Jason Weems' life.
Yeah, I. You know, when I watched the special, I was like, couldn't even get a special thanks in my credits.
What's up with that? I was looking for it, Mike. It wasn't there.
I understand people helped film the special, but you know, if it wasn't for this guy, I'm just glad he's all right. I love that guy.
Yeah, no, he's great, and what a great special too.
Yeah, it was. And I'm glad great you guys special. Talked about it. It is really a great special. And he's just one, you know how like some people, you know, like John, you know this with music, and Steve, you know this with music, and Ronald, obviously with Tommy, like you meet some people and even without seeing them perform or whatever, you just can be around them for a few minutes and go, you should be famous.
Yeah.
Or you totally. Should like, and Weems is like that for me. Like he just has like and Milner, who was born in the USA, like they have like special qualities that it goes beyond like being a good actor or a good comedian or a good musician. It's just, there's this like this presence and charisma. And Weems is just the most talented dude I know. And you know, everyone,
I believe they call it
who he is. The It Factor. Yeah.
Of course. Weems has got it. Well, we've got it, but we've only got a few minutes to talk about it. We gave you the impossible task of picking your favorite movie or TV show of the last 10 years, as though you can even do that. I don't know if you're good at picking favorites or if this was a struggle for you, but within a few minutes of me suggesting it, you said, I've got the movie. So
yeah, let's hear it.
So yeah, it's interesting because like part of me wants to pick one of my little artsy fartsy movies that no one has heard of, and you guys roll your eyes or whatever. Or I thought about naming one of my own movies.
There you go.
I'm like, they're not the best, but like I love them. But no, it's easy. Or I almost threw up Hillbilly Elegy just to make myself laugh. And then Ronald would act like it's good, and I would text John later and be like, what the fuck's wrong with Ronald for saying Hillbilly Elegy got merit? The movie, that it was obvious for me because this movie I've seen in the movie I saw in the movie theater three times. Each time it got better. I saw it in three different types of spaces. I know all three of you guys love this movie too. Get Out is my favorite movie of the last 10 years.
Nice.
To me, it's not even close either. Like I think of that too, and I know that whenever I see like the best movies of the decade list that came out like a year ago, like Social Network's great, and there's so many like really strong movies, and there's so many great artists putting out their best work over the last 10 years. But Get Out's a perfect movie, and I think that there's a reason why I saw that. Like I said, I saw that movie in three different movie theaters. And it was like, one was like a matinee during a weekday with 10 people. One of them was in like a mostly black audience on a Saturday night. And then one of them was like, I really wanted my wife to see it. We saw it like in like I think it was like mostly like tweens or something seeing it. And it's a reason why the movie translates in all these different ways. And then even like when the movie came out, I was talking to my in-laws who were 60 something year old, you know, white people who you would think are the Bradley Whitford and Catherine Keener characters, but we're just like, we saw, have you heard of this movie, Get Out? It's amazing. And the fact that like it translates to that many different people and types of people, like that movie just really special. And I also love movies that when you see them, only a specific person or artist could have made, you know, that thing. And Jordan Peele is just like such an amazing filmmaker, and to come out with that movie right out of the gate, it's so special and so cool.
Yeah, I think what's special about that is it's a great pick, by the way. It's definitely on a short list for me. But it's like such a rare thing for that movie, like a movie like that to come along. It is lightning in a bottle. Like, you know, a person like Jordan Peele kind of subverting what everybody thinks about him, you know, in the comedy world, and Key and Peele and anything he had done prior to that. And to think about what it did for his career, to think about what it's done for Daniel's career, you know, who just won an Oscar last weekend, you know, it's just, and it's just like, there hasn't been a movie. I probably argue it is the one that in the last 10 years has probably been the most zeitgeist movie that I can watch over and over again. And I agree is a perfect movie because, you know, it just has something to say at a period in time, and it's perfectly cast. It's perfectly written. I mean, he won an Oscar for the screenplay for that movie. Mm-hmm. You know, it is just a gem. Should have won
Best Picture.
You're absolutely right. Yeah. It should have. But
that's going to be the movie people still talk about in 30 years.
And that's key. That's a great point. Yeah. And I think you're right. And I think, wow, what a movie. And to just announce the arrival of someone like Jordan Peele and what he's doing with Monkey Paw, like everything he touches really is like, we always talk about it on the podcast. It's like anything he's associated with, we have to see it immediately.
Yeah.
Because something about it will be interesting.
Yeah. And you know what? The two things about that, and I think you're spot on, Steve, about it being the most zeitgeisty movie. This is how you know he's a true artist and is building something special. His next movie is already on a studio calendar for a summer release, and it's called The Untitled Jordan Peele Project.
That's true.
Very, very few directors have that. Like,
that's true.
Nolan has that. Paul Thomas Anderson has that in a different way. But the fact that like a summer movie schedule is going to be built around any director is pretty crazy. Yeah. The other thing, and I thought my wife actually made, when I was talking to her about Get Out, because I told her about John texting me about this podcast, is the fact that when you know something is good when you see it imitated a billion times in good and bad ways.
Oh, yeah.
And we've seen so many horror trailers or social horror trailers. Just the fact that that's a genre now shows how special Get Out is. Like, she's read books that like novels that you're like, oh, this is like so Get Out-esque. Like, it's become its own genre.
It's an adjective, yeah.
Yeah, like Jordan Peele stuff has become like so imitated in just a short period of time. Like, that doesn't know how special it is.
It's a great pick. Yeah. It's a great pick.
The fact that people say like you're in the sunken place, that there were like think pieces, like, is Kanye West in
the sunken place? No.
Yeah.
Just that, you know, that's whatever you call that. That face. Screenshot, whatever, yeah.
I really felt awkward when John just said that to Ronald. I was
That was weird.
I'm so sorry.
No,
I get what you were saying. But the fact that in our lifetimes, two sayings have become like regular things. In the Matrix and in the sunken place. Those are two things that people just rattle off as random, like, oh, you know, I was in the Matrix, you know, or he was in the Matrix, or it was in the Matrix.
And it's become pop culture shorthand. Like,
yeah,
totally. Yeah, totally.
I hear Sunken Place constantly. So, yeah, you're right, man. That's a powerful movie.
Great pick. Well, Mike, it's awesome to see you. We would love to have you come back and do a whole episode with us when we have a little more time to stretch out and really just ramble. But thanks for making time for this.
Can I say something? Oh, of course. Yes. Yeah, I just want to say one thing really, really quick. I genuinely consider all three of you guys friends. I love you to death. I love the show. I've known Ronald forever through stand-up, and I always, probably like 10 years at this point. And I remember seeing him at open mics and thinking he was funny. I was like, you know what I like about that guy? He's like the only local comedian without a podcast. And then my friend Chris LaMartina was on this show, and I listened to it, not knowing anything about the show. And John did the interview, And I was like, this is a good show. Let's listen to more. And then I listened to the next one and Ronald was on it. It took me half the episode to think like, oh, that's my friend. And no idea.
And, that's awesome.
Because at the beginning of the show, you just say, hi, I'm Steve, I'm John, I'm Ronald. And I'm like, who's this Ronald guy?
I try to wait until as late as possible in every new relationship to reveal that I do podcasts, because I kind of feel like it has that, like, the fear you have is that, like, everybody thinks you're walking up to them going, you want to be on my podcast? You want to be on my podcast? But the truth is, if you meet someone interesting, it is kind of like, oh, gosh, I bet that'd be a pretty good
I kind of want to have them on the podcast.
So thank you for always being such a good get, Mike. And we'll definitely talk again soon. You look great. And congrats on that beautiful baby and that beautiful life.
Thanks, guys. Love you guys. Take care.
You too, man. Good seeing you.
Yeah.
All right.
Mikey.
Guess who was waiting in the waiting room?
Oh, my God. Oh, we are just wham, bam. Bring him in, John.
Guest is in the waiting room.
Let's go.
And
it is the one and only.
Hey. Oh, crap.
Cass Conti.
Sorry, guys. I'm at my dad's house. You know.
Oh, hey. There he is. Hey.
Hey, man.
You changed your name.
Wrong guy.
Cass Conti.
Like Cass.
Yes,
Cass is pretty cool.
Nice to see you guys.
Great you to see too, you, man. Too. You're looking great.
Hell, I've been traveling all day long, so forgive me if I look a little disheveled and stuff. But, you know, nice to see you guys. It's been way too long for sure.
Yeah. You totally look like you're in your parents' house.
I am totally.
I love the yeah.
There's a certain kind of chandelier that people just don't buy anymore, you know?
Yeah.
Is that a piano under the chandelier?
Is that a white piano under the chandelier? Yeah.
Absolutely.
Wow.
Oh, man.
Are your parents Liberace?
Am I coming through okay? Or
Yeah. Sound great.
Yeah.
Okay. Sound good, man.
Gotcha, man.
We're just gonna. Can we just smile at each other for 15 minutes? Because this is a great reunion. This is
a good time, man. It's been too long.
It's kind of worth it. So, John, is that your basement after it's been redone and everything?
Yes, this stuff was sort of here before, but the if I turn the computer, I'll pull cables free. But yes, this is the.
It looks
new,
all fancy.
It's a much more functional, like family.
So much. I mean, I haven't talked to you in forever. It's been way too long to just do a catch up and stuff, but. I wish I could take my dad's got an iMac because, old, so you don't do portable devices, but I wish I could take it and walk you downstairs because my comic collection is downstairs, which takes up two full rooms. And it would just like blow Ron's mind. So, it'd be like, okay.
That's so great.
But it is nerdy headquarters, Yeah. Gotcha. So.
Well, funnily enough, the last episode you were on was 169. It was an episode called Marvel Schmarvel.
Yeah,
which was released in August 15th of 2016, and that's where we kind of looked at all the MCU films up at that point and ranked them. We now have a YouTube only spinoff called Marvel Schmarvel, where we talk about the Marvel shows when they come out on Disney Plus. So that's kind of like, in a weird way, that was the backdoor pilot for our spinoff.
That's cool. I've never been invited to that.
I know, that's what I'm saying. We should have him on Marvel Schmarvel. That's what I'm leading up to.
I'd like to point out I was also not invited to episode 177, Rogue One, 185, Kong versus Logan, which would have been a great like mix.
Yeah.
189, Game of Thrones, 192.5, Wonder Woman, 196, Game of Thrones again, 2105, Thor Ragnarok, 202.5, Justice League, 208, The Black Panther, 211 top MCU moments, which surely seems like an oversight.
Yeah, we missed that one for sure.
Yeah, 214, The Avengers Infinity Wars, 215, Han Solo. I thought that was actually a pretty good movie.
I loved it.
Then 227, Captain Marvel, 235, pre-gaming, The Game of Thrones on the day of my birthday.
Oh, wow.
Then 236, The Avengers, 237, Game of Thrones wrap-up, 247, Skywalker, Schmiewalker, 250, I actually know quite a bit about the Trolls World Tour. I've seen it about six times at this point. 291, the Zack Snyder JLA cut, and 294, Kong versus Godzilla. So there.
This is when you say, fuck you, I'm out.
No. If there's one thing we learn right now is that we can fix this. Let's just go back and re-record all those.
Yeah.
Yes.
And we'll replace every episode.
Put you in them.
I don't expect to get invited back till like episode 500 at this point, but
The truth is, though, now we're in this era where this is much easier. Like, honestly, a lot of that was done we would do phoners when we had to, but we weren't doing Zoom. And we were just talking about this with our previous guest that, like, I mean, I used to run from a video call when I would be on the phone with someone and they would say, hop on FaceTime, let me show you. And I would be like, no, that's not the world I'm in. Like, now it's so easy. And it seems like it's obvious that why that is because this is how you socialize now, or at least this is the best, most fluent way. We've all become a little bit less closed off, I think, from the idea of video chatting.
It was funny when you guys started doing the phoners, because I actually thought the sound quality was better than when you were in the room together.
Three mics that you can isolate. That's true. It actually makes it easier because there's no crosstalk. There's no like echo from the other guy's mic. So
now that I've stopped ribbing you guys for everything, but it's great to see you guys. I know you wanted to talk about like favorite movie in the last 10 years.
I know it's a simple, big question. Simple question. Right?
Yeah. I'd say it's simple, right? Yeah. I mean, you know what your pick is, right, Jason? No thought went into it. You just knew immediately.
No thought went in.
You were visibly stressed about this.
I did go back and forth on it because I was like, oh, I really like that movie. I had to be super predictable about this. And I mean, it sort of ends caps what we talked about in the beginning of the episode I was on, but you know, and I'm going to pull a John here and do one of my favorite John things and sneak in too, because
that's like, what you do. It's called a Walker.
I stopped. I think you'd have to go way back to find the last Walker, but I definitely, it was only because it was defined for me too many times that I stopped doing it. But I think if we track it, we'll find that everybody walkers sometimes.
It was like he stopped and it was my favorite thing, you know? The two-part Avengers finale for me was just, the culmination of like, you know, so many years of geekdom and coming up and then being able to see Thanos done really well. And I mean, especially like, cause there was a bit there where the JLA, like if you guys know your comic history, Thanos was actually invented as Marvel's response to Darkseid because Stan Lee thought they got this really cool character. We've got to come out with something like that. And now, you know, everybody can walk around and say, they know who Thanos is. And you know, we only really know Darkseid from the Zack Snyder cut, and he didn't catch on to the same point from a merchandising standpoint. But, it's just become such a weird world for me where, I can walk around and say Hail Hydra to people and they know what I'm talking about. And it's the thing that gets you laughed at by girls anymore. And there's like, white kids dressing up as Black Panther, which is, amazing to me because, for years that was it. You had to, if you're in Ron's shoes, you want to play Superman. That's it. That's cool. But, Superman doesn't look like you, definitely. They have like some diversity actually now out there and, say like the best movie, their best performing movie was actually the Black Panther. That's really crazy to me. So just how that whole universe has taken hold of everything, it makes me feel at some point I'm like, dang, I really should have stuck with writing comic books or something like that. I'd be like king of the world right now instead of sitting in my dad's living room, but, this is where I'm at,
No, that's a great I mean, honestly, if you're going to pick a crowd-pleasing type of movie and say this is like the perfect, not just a kind of perfect cinematic experience in some ways, but also like something that marks the last 10 years, the bookend of those two movies, really one big story, maybe even the second part the most in terms of like, there's just, I mean, we talk about memes and cultural moments lifted from movies. These movies have spawned, like, so many scenes have become iconic to people, both as jokes, but also as scenes that genuinely move you. Like the Cap moment with the hammer in Endgame, I refer to it a few times a week with people who aren't even comic book fans or nerds or movie fans. Like everyone just knows that feeling, that moment of like, that was so satisfying. And I think to me, that's one of the last times I remember being in a theater and having that kind of like huge moment. Like, I can't wait. What's going to be that next, Darth Vader throwing the Emperor down the shaft kind of moment in a theater with a crowd? Like, I really look forward to that. That was such a great, huge moment. So yeah, the great pick.
The only thing I would have changed about that movie is the very end when Iron Man dies, if he had instead said, I am Tony Stark, and went like that. Cause I think it would have been a nice bookend to the end of Iron Man where he's like, I'm Iron Man. And all of a sudden he circles back around. But, no one will ever be able to pull off like, hi, I'm going to start this and 15 years later, I'm going to finish this up, and it's going to go through a series of movies. We've watched so many people try to do the contained universe since then. And, with really, really mixed results. So, but hey, they did it, and it's pretty much all been great, I would say. So,
Yeah, I wonder if even they could do it again. Like we talk about that. Well, what could be the next big thing that would feel as momentous as what they've already done? And it's hard to imagine.
You just got to commit, man. I mean, like we talk about all the time, which is just that at this point, and even halfway through what they've already accomplished, everybody's just like, if you're on, you're on board and you're just like ready for whatever they do next. And, you know, they cap that whole effort off and whatever phase four looks like. And, you know, in 15 years from now or whatever, however long it takes to maybe that they're going to build towards some similar moment, I'm sure. But I think that if anything has ever earned the confidence and, you know, just like the faith in the fact that they will probably still accomplish something huge, I don't know that it'll ever reach like the levels of the Endgame experience. Like John, like everybody said, you know, even, you know, when we're recording this, it's like the week of the 2-year anniversary of Endgame coming out in theaters. And, you know, the filmmakers, the Russo brothers, the actors like posting things about, you know, what the movie meant to them as participants in it, but also, you know, the clips of audiences watching it genuinely move me. Like I get so emotional and like, you know, like goosebumps and like the moments like John's talking about with the hammer or the snap with Iron Man or everybody coming through the portals.
Yeah,
like
on your left. I hear people say that all
stuff.
The time.
That stuff is just, it's untouchable. Like, I don't know that it'll ever happen again, but I like to see them try. And I think that if somebody can probably accomplish it's probably them. But Endgame, yeah, the best theatrical experience I've ever had in my life, for sure. And God, man, what a great pick. Yeah.
I think it gets underrated a lot because it's a popcorn movie. But, you know, I mean, there's just so many ripples from it.
It's absolutely true. Absolutely, it's a great, great choice. Great choice.
Yeah. And favorite TV show, I mean, I'm going to go with Game of Thrones. Am I allowed to talk about where we all met?
Yeah. Yeah.
So I'll just tell a quick story. So we were working at the Apple store, and it was an Apple store that I was in charge of. And one day the whole Genius Bar crashes to a halt, and I can't figure out what's going on, but we are way, way behind. And the crowd is getting really ugly, as you guys can remember, when, you know, there's nobody, but there's no one at the bar at all.
Yeah.
So I go in the back, and like literally there's like 12 people in the Genius room, and they're all talking very animated, they're like super passionate about something. I figure something's going on with some customer, and I'm like, what's going on? And then I forgot they're talking about some TV show, and I just lost my mind. And it was, they had a season one had just ended, Ned Stark's just gotten beheaded, you know, and they're all so worked up and upset about it. And I'm like, everybody get out of there, you know, and stuff like that. And I remember at the time I made this note to myself, like, go home and watch that immediately.
Don't show any interest, but watch it tonight.
Yeah, that show brought an Apple store to a halt. You
know? Right.
The ending being what it was still the only show I would say over the last 10 years that I didn't just go back and crush like Breaking Bad or something like that, where I was like, every week I was waiting for it.
Yeah.
You know, and I would actively go back when the season was over and rewatch the whole season to get ready, you know, for the next season.
Did you read the books?
Yeah, I have no free time, and I spent an awful lot of it on that show.
Did you read the books?
I did not.
Okay, see, I would have thought you, I mean, you would have been either in at the ground floor from the beginning, or you would have been finding out about the show from you know, people at work. You know what I mean? Because for a lot of people, the show was a different ride because they were huge fans of the books. You know, the way that certain people, like I grew up with Lord of the Rings or whatever, so those movies had this weird, like, oh, they're doing it so well, but I'm also comparing it in my head to the movie in my head. And I think what Game of Thrones did for at least 4 or 5 years was they managed to somehow please both audiences pretty well. That the changes they made from the books, we were all going like fans of the books. I caught up with the books after the first season, but I don't think I ever spoiled anything for anyone. My wife, when the Red Wedding happened on the show, she turned to me and she was like, how did you not say anything about that? And I was like, oh my God, it's been so fucking hard. But I don't like being that coy non-spoiler where someone's like, just wait and see, you know, whatever. So, but I don't know. I think that it was a huge thing, and it was kind of the Marvel in a weird way. It was like the thing everyone was talking about and was
definitely
interested in. And then when those last couple seasons sort of came out, I feel like the curious case of Game of Thrones is of a show that somehow nobody really talks much about it now because of the last couple seasons. But yeah, for 5-6 years, it was like, it was like the thing that you could count on people.
It's like
people
a relationship that ended badly. So I think we all can kind of not remember.
Yeah. Good times. Yeah. Yeah. So,
you know, but I think about halfway through, I sort of figured out that I didn't think that George R. R. Martin was ever actually going to finish the books.
It seems like, more and more like that.
And I'm like, I'm not starting because I'll get so mad because I'll never be able to finish it. So, you know. Mm-hmm. the show is my show, and that's it.
Yeah, that's great. That's awesome. Well, those are both great picks, and they do mark the last, you know, the last decade pretty effectively. So
I went real populist. I'm sorry.
You know, nah, man, this is great. Sort of guy.
This I think this is why we get along. Yeah, that's it. That's it.
Have you watched the Blu-rays by any chance? The Game of Thrones Blu-rays?
Mm-mm. Nah.
Worth it.
Do yourselves a favor. It doesn't even look like the same show. I know that sounds weird. The Blu-ray upgrades, the 4K upgrades are, it's, if HBO Max decides to put the 4K ones on HBO Max, if they decide to put them on there, it's going to change the way that people watch that show. It just is. It's already a gorgeous show. It looks like a different show at that point. Like, it's insane.
Every time resolution has gotten better, I've wondered, like, why would I care? And then I see something and I'm like, okay, right. Yeah, this does look really good. Like, yeah, I can't. Yeah. And then you go back to something else. I think particularly with the, as screens get larger, you really can notice those, you know, the improvements.
Check out the Blu-rays. I thought the same thing about The Wire. I was like, why would I want to see a Wire upgrade? And then I saw the HD upgrades. I'm like, oh, this is, they just show more of the scene. It's like,
yeah,
go check it out.
All right.
Cool.
So you even got a recommendation for your trouble, Jason. Yeah, but
I mean, I'm still trying to find the zipper in the back of the Creature of the Black Lagoon's costume, so I don't really know that I'm going to be the guy who appreciates the upgrade, you know. been 45 years looking for that one, you know. Yeah.
Well, it's good to find something you care about and stick with it, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, good to see you guys.
Yeah, thank you so much, Jason.
Yeah, Jason, thanks for coming
Steve,
on.
I love all your father stories that you're posting on Facebook. I mean, you know, anyone get lucky enough to have Steve as a dad, it'd be great.
Oh, man, thank you.
Congratulations, man. You know, it's nice to see you. I don't know if you're settling down, but, you know, it's good to see you happy with somebody. So, you know, I'm pleased for that.
So, Jason, you're too kind, buddy. We love you, guy.
Yeah, we'll have you back on soon, honestly, for a whole episode. This will be
the 500. I'll count myself.
Yeah. Put it on the calendar.
And we know you're actually counting. So, yeah. All right.
Bye, see you, Jason.
Bye, Jason.
Take care.
And he is.
Cool.
All right, cool. And we actually have our next guest waiting. So I'm going to admit him. I'm going to say on in 10, just so he knows. 10, 9, 8. If I was a viewer or a listener, I'd be really wondering now. 6, 7, 10.
You're going back up.
9, 3, 0. Here is our next guest. The one and only drawing of Bob Rose.
The best representation of Sir Bob Rose. There he is.
Hey, what's up, guys?
What is up, buddy?
I just installed Zoom on this computer, so I hope everything is okay.
Oh, you can tell he's a professional podcaster. Listen to that quality. Okay, coming through loud and clear.
Well, I even brought on my, I put on my headphones on for you, John, because I know.
Thank you.
Oh, man.
Those the standard that John keeps for us on this podcast.
Yeah. Oh, I've talked to him in private about podcasting equipment and the troubles of the pandemic podcasting specifically.
Yeah.
My standards are way lower than his. And I know I'm kind of a jerk about it. So
John keeps us honest, man. If it were up to me, we would just record on like a Fisher Price, my first tape recorder.
And we'd mail it in the mail to him. Yeah.
The video has loosened me up a little bit because just knowing that now there's a form of it that's going out that's relatively raw, it's like, okay, there's only so much you even need to do. And I know that I knew that all along. I just also know from my own listening habits that there are occasionally technical things that make you go, I wish they had fixed that before they put this out for me to listen to, you know, but it is very possible to overthink that when it's all about just the content. And especially in this current era, people come through with every kind of sound quality on like Zoom calls, which is what most podcasts are now.
So like on a cell phone next to the highway in portrait mode, just screaming into the guy with like perfect studio sound. Yeah, I've been that guy.
Yeah.
So
you recently posted something, Bob, where you referred to it as like, if you want to see us dimly lit in weird rooms, then you can watch this YouTube, you know.
Right.
But it's like, that's an acceptable format of entertainment now, is murky, pixelated people leaning in and out of shadows, you know.
I literally just turned on all the lights in this room because the window is blowing me out so bad. Like,
that's hilarious.
I was trying to make it slightly better, and even now my face is on fire.
You look great, man. You look great.
Thank you. You look great too. You seriously do. You got a nice diffusion light by the curtain there.
Oh, over here.
And Ronald's got like a very dynamic lighting on one side of his face. It's nice.
Yeah. I just moved into this house not too long ago, and there's no light.
There's no ceiling. Can you see there's display. No ceiling? That's just sunlight.
It just goes. It's like a sitcom set. It just goes up forever.
Yeah. It's just four walls.
Yeah. Right. Nice.
We'll pull down the angry sun like Super Mario Brothers. It's like, woo, woo.
Honestly, out of the three of you, John has the flattest lighting. So that's surprising. I mean, the standards. Well, there's
actually, I've actually got a pretty cool lighting setup here. Like, if, see, I've got this light here. If, as you turn it around, you lose years off your face if you hit the wall instead. But I have a ring light over here that's kind of filling things in. So it's orchestrated. But my look is like dungeon. You know, like that's my whole thing I'm going for. It's I want to be like a conspiracy clean theory guy, but in a dungeon.
Yeah. You're like a conspiracy theory guy living in a van down by the river type of thing.
Got to keep moving.
Gotcha. Yeah.
But I do have a ring light. Even a van, you can find room for a ring light. So Bob, the last time you were on was episode 138. This is crazy. It was an episode called Critics Schmittix, back on July 10th of 2015. And it was, I love this format. I would love to do some version of this again. We all came in with some of our favorite movies that all had under a 30% on Metacritic.
Oh, yeah.
And it was, very fun. I mean, obviously it'll be very hard maybe for you to recap the last 6 years, Bob, but if you can help us out, just let us know what's been going on since July of 2015. Quick.
You mean in my personal life or in
anything,
movies?
Anything you want to say, we'll talk about your favorite movie in a second.
Well, there's a few things happened in the world.
Oh, really?
What do you want me to say for the last 6 years?
Just quickly, Bob,
you're taking too much time. It's not hard, Bob. Just 6 years, man.
Everything was great and perfect, and I've never been happier. How's that?
Okay, there you go. That's good.
I knew you could do it.
Yeah, the best year of my life. Last year is the best year of my life, easily, without a doubt. Yeah, it's just incredible. Yeah.
Who knew that the This Is Fine dog was going to be legitimately like, this is the summary of civilization?
Well, I mean, if we're going to be honest, my life used to be so terrible. I would see Steve like once every 2 weeks. And once that had to stop, now my life is great.
Yeah.
Okay. Actually, my life has gotten considerably worse not seeing Steve every like 2 weeks.
Oh,
so,
damn.
Yeah.
Yeah, man, even outside of screenings, I'd see you getting breakfast, and we don't even have that anymore.
Right, we don't have. Yeah, it's so great, wonderful stuff. Anyway,
I miss seeing you at the movies, man.
I miss seeing you guys too. I miss the movies. Yeah, also themselves.
Yeah, blanket statement. Yeah,
yeah, I'm so bad. Hopefully that'll be back before 2022.
Yeah,
hopefully.
We were just talking about that, like the idea of like that big cinematic experience. One of our guests picked a movie that was a big populist hit, and we were just talking about those crowd pleasing moments where you just remember being in that crowd almost as much as you remember the movie moment. Yeah. And that is it's hard for me to even picture when I'll feel comfortable in a crowd like that again. But I'm sure something will one day be that next thing that gets us all going together again.
I'll say this: I feel like I'm not a religious man, but I think there is some godly force to let Endgame happen before the pandemic. Like to have that experience in a theater, that moment was like enough on the camel hump to get you
to survive.
That was actually the movie that was picked since you brought it up. I wasn't going to bring it up in case it spoiled.
I mean, how could anyone not pick? I mean, you know what I mean? Like for people like us, that's like the ultimate theater experience that was worked up for what, 10 years.
Right.
And then a pandemic hit. It was kind of perfect timing.
Yeah.
So
it was, man.
Yeah.
So that's your pick.
No.
He just was referring to the sort of crowd pleasing moment. He just zeroed in on exactly the movie I was vaguely.
I love Endgame. I wasn't trying to say it's not. Okay. It's just not. I mean, of the last 10 years, it's not nearly my favorite movie.
Yeah.
John rephrased it to me, my favorite movie or TV show of the last 10 years.
Yes.
Is that that's what the question is?
Yes.
All right, so that's an impossible question.
Yes, it is.
As you all know, it's a really shitty, mean thing to do to somebody.
Yes, it was terrible. And we're terrible. So we should feel bad.
I made a top five of both categories. Just
is this a new term that we're going to come up with? There was a walkering of things where you have like two picks.
Bob Rosa.
We're about to get rosed. Things are getting rosy in here.
Boom. He's about to
have I just want to be difficult.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Because I don't, you know, it's hard to make the lists. You know, I mean, I kind of have an idea of my favorite movies of all time, but when it comes to, I'm like, I'm forgetting things.
I'm forgetting things.
I know I am. I'm probably forgetting things even with this, but I spent like 2 days thinking of this.
Wow. Thank you.
So you're welcome. So for TV shows, number one, easily without question, there is no other, is Nathan For You. 100,000%. It's like the funny to me, that's like the funniest thing I've ever seen in my life.
Yeah,
I know that's not narrative, so that probably doesn't fit the movie schmovie.
No, but it's done. It's totally fine. Yeah, absolutely.
I think it's tell a story, to be honest. Yeah. I think it tells the story of a character.
Yeah,
but that would be number one. Number two, be review
trending here.
You guys have seen Review, right?
Oh, yeah, yes. One of the best things ever by one of the best comedy geniuses we have.
Yeah. Not nearly loved enough.
No.
At all. Third is one that I think it's a weird choice for a lot of people. You're the Worst.
Oh, it's great.
You're the Worst is so good.
Right?
So good.
Not it's talked so about good. That much. I don't hear anything
at all,
about
really.
It.
Yeah.
I just thought that show was incredible. I really did. Four, Russian Doll. I really love Russian Doll. Yeah, I thought it was great. I don't know if there's ever going to be more of it, but whatever. Five is kind of maybe a cop-out because it's not over, but Barry.
Barry is so good.
I mean, who doesn't love Barry? That's it, you know. But maybe it'll get really terrible. I mean, Dexter started out really good. Remember what happened? So
you just have to wait like a little while for the Barry reboot where they redeem whatever is about to happen that's bad. But yeah, I think, you know, I think one of the secret things about Barry, and it's like something that no one really talked that much about, but one of those things you realize as time goes on, is that everybody loves Bill Hader. You know, it's
he's hard to hate.
He's like easily recognized by many people as an extremely talented comedian and a brilliant sketch artist and a brilliant impressionist. And he seems to have nothing but goodwill. And yet I feel like he somehow managed to avoid, like he somehow stays off the radar, but everybody knows who he is. He's almost got that utility player, Bill Hartman thing. It's not quite the same vibe, but it's a similar thing of like, he saved so many sketches just by being like a really good sketch performer. And he, there's something kind of chameleonic movies. About that. Yeah.
Right.
It's hard to put a finger on what it is that works so well, but Bill Hader's just someone who, and then when he made this show and it was about a hitman, it sort of sounded like, have we not seen hitmen done to death? But no, not like this at all. And not with this cast and not with this tone. So yeah, what a great pick.
Yeah. It's surprising how good, I didn't expect that show to hit me like that, but
yeah,
I watched that during the pandemic and I was like, it saved me for like a week, you know. Movies. I'm going to go backwards because some of these are really surprising, especially for a guy like me. You guys kind of know my tastes. You know, I like comedies and action movies and this is weird. Number five, About Time.
Oh my God. That's a good movie.
Isn't that a great movie? I love that movie.
Oh my God.
I find myself watching it quite a bit. I know people hate Richard Curtis and he has made some mistakes.
Yeah.
But man, that movie I don't know. It speaks to me. And plus time travel.
Right,
you know,
and it works, but like a secret time travel. I love that, where it's like,
yeah,
it's time travel, but it's really about the emotional content, or it's time travel, but it's really about the people. Yeah, that's
it's amazing. Also, like, I'm always impressed as someone who, you know, makes some stuff every now and then, like, oh, you made a really good time travel movie with literally no special effects or technology,
right?
Like, it's
true,
it's shot like it's, you know, a drama and there's no lightning or anything like that, and it still totally works. Three, not surprising at all, Thor Ragnarok. Ooh, that's so probably good. My favorite MCU movie outside of Guardians 2. But I watched that movie in the background like once every 2 weeks, like literally.
Right.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I watched Thor Ragnarok a lot. Why? Do you hate it? Is that what?
No, I love it.
Oh, okay.
No, we're all, big fans.
You know, we have more access to the MCU movies with Disney Plus, and I find myself not watching them as much as I thought I would, but I'm gonna watch Ragnarok. You're making me want to watch it.
We were just this morning, my son and I, talking about Love and Thunder, just everything we know about that movie. And it's like, I cannot wait for that. That's
going to be awesome.
Swagger of a team coming back that did something.
There
cool.
It is.
Yeah, there you go. But of a team coming back that did something cool last time that really revitalized the character. But now they know how much everyone liked it. So, I mean, it's possible one day Taika Waititi might misjudge how charming we think he is and how funny his ideas are, but I don't think so. I think that guy's one of those true filmmakers and true storytellers, and he's got such a kind heart and such good humor. I can't imagine that movie not being at least fun, but it might be something really amazing.
Like, I mean, easily Thor Ragnarok's the best Thor movie. I like the other Thor movies. I'm one of those guys.
You're a Thor guy. Like,
I'm a Thor guy, and I think the sincerity of the other movies, I still buy it. But honestly, the second best Thor movie is Infinity War. It's like half a Thor movie, and it's great, but Thor Ragnarok,
Rabbit and Tree along for the ride.
Too good. It's too good. There's a lot of pathos in there. once we got past like society reacting to him being fat in Endgame, I also thought there was so much pathos in his performance and everything.
Yeah. Yeah.
You watch it now alone in your house.
Mm-hmm.
It reads totally different.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah,
that opening.
Yeah. He's like the heart of that movie.
He is. Ways. He really is. And it really comes off way different. It's not a fat joke. You can actually see there's like pathos there and everything.
Well, you know why it works as not a fat joke, I think, is because when he gets his mojo back, it's about accepting himself, not about suddenly emerging as like this chiseled being. And it's like, I know they're probably, I've seen photos of him with amazingly huge arms. So I know they're not going to let him stay out of shape Thor for a long time. But the notion that him getting himself on the right path wasn't like a makeover. It was more about,
it was mental.
Yeah. That was cool.
And also, like, it's not funny that somebody's fat. It's funny that Thor was fat.
Right. It's funny that guy. Yeah, that he's such a guy's guy that he would sit around video games and
that he's a god. Like stuff. Them getting fat, we don't even know what that entails.
Right.
Like, yeah.
Whatever. Like how? Right.
Like how? How much beer did he have to drink?
Right.
Like what amounts were we talking here? I still say. The thing that Disney should do that they never will is they should have a 3-camera sitcom with 5 seasons of the 5 years in between the 2 movies.
Oh wow.
Meet Thor and then all 3 of them just playing video games and hanging out, and it's like a shot, like Big Bang Theory or something.
Yeah.
Chris Hemsworth will never do that, but I think that's a great idea. Anyway, 2 Kingsman, the Secret Service, the first one. That's not a movie that I ever thought I'd like. The trailers were terrible. I watch it so much now. I don't know. That movie speaks to me, the humor in it, and obviously the church scene. And Matthew Vaughn is one of my favorite filmmakers now, especially after that. So
yeah.
I never thought I would say that. Looking back over the list, and number 1, Nebraska. Which is
no one expected me to say that. They're both like Forte and Odenkirk and Squibb. Yeah. I'd say their last names.
I mean, the cast is unbreakable, man. It's great. Yeah. And I watched Nebraska a lot. Like I put it on to relax, and there's something about the dry humor and just the, middle American white people being awkward that I just love.
And that drive through town at the end.
Yeah. Right.
Man. That gets me so hard every time. Just the simple humanity of that is so great.
I love Napoleon Dynamite. I do. But to me, Nebraska is like an adult's Napoleon Dynamite. You know what I mean? It's more mature themes. It's more mature in general. And it cuts off that weirdness and it makes it real. It has real emotion to it. And I don't know. I don't understand why it didn't win the Oscar. But then again, we're not talking about the Oscars.
Yeah, right. We did that last week or a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, right. So, yeah, there you have
those are some great picks, Bob.
Good picks, dude.
I think there's some variation, too. I was trying not to be like all MCU movies.
Yeah, man, that's good. Yeah. Mix it up.
Yeah, so.
I'm glad you went outside of the format, man. I like that you gave us some.
He just muscled in and said, this is a top 5 situation.
There it is.
Well, what do you want me to do, man? No, I'll pick one?
Yeah.
Or I just was supposed to say one thing, so I probably should have said Nebraska.
You should have said, we were hoping you would say the name of one movie quickly and then top off the call. Like, hey, guys, it's Nebraska. Bye.
Yeah, bye.
You know what I almost said, but I looked up. I was very specific about the time period because you said 10 years. So I was like, it's 2011.
Oh, yeah.
I almost said MacGruber.
Okay.
MacGruber is so good.
Dude, I MacGruber is like life defining for me. Man. I love it.
Yeah.
So I Forte,
Yeah, there he is.
Once again, the Forte is really at the top for me. And I number 6 in my list would have been Last Man Alive.
Yeah. Last Man on Earth.
Last Man on Earth, yeah. Except I feel like that show got neutered.
It did.
And I feel like it takes away from it. Sad, not their fault, but it does.
It takes away from it as you're getting close to those last few episodes where you go, oh, they had a plan. And I've read them talking about their plan, and they've talked about it so much that I feel like they're never going to go back and make it because they kind of spoiled what their plan would have been. Anyway, I agree. Yeah. It does feel like
it's so good. It's like so incredible. And then it's unfairly maligned at the end.
Right.
But I am a big Forte fan. So. Right.
Well, Bob, we want to have you back soon to stay for a whole episode.
Let me know. I'm down. Awesome.
Well, this was so fun and easy. Thank you so much for making time for it. You're definitely one of the best friends of the show we've had. So,
man.
So.
Anytime you guys want, let me know.
All right, man. Take care of yourself, Bob.
Bye-bye. See you guys.
Bye. All right.
This is a great little trip, man. Like seeing all these faces beyond mm-hmm. just knowing that they are alive and well and happy and successful. But getting them back on here has been a lot of fun.
And
so
we
far.
Have another guest waiting.
Yeah. We got one more.
All right.
We got
one more. Go. Here's our last guest of the day.
Let's just circle back real quick. We got an Apple history here. Would this be the one more thing?
Yes, this is the
one more thing.
Yeah. I should have worn a mock turtleneck. I'm really sorry.
Yeah. I can make it look like.
Yeah. You got like the Tim Cook thing going, you know.
Yeah, I got it. Yeah. I got you.
All right. Well, let's bring him in.
There she is. There's sort of. I see some audio connecting.
Wait, how do I do the video? Oh, wait.
You hit the video button. There you go.
And yay!
There she is.
Lauren. Hey, hello. Great to see you.
Hey, good to see you guys too.
Thanks for bringing us into your bedroom.
It's the quietest room.
Very well lit.
You're in your bedroom.
You're right, I am. Hey. I'm just not showing off my headboard, that's all.
Yeah.
It's a nice one, though.
Do you have a quilted headboard?
I do not.
Okay, see, there you go. That's probably why you're not showing it off.
Yeah, I do not. One day I will, though. Maybe episode 400. By the time we get there, I'll be able to get a quilted headboard.
Well, Lauren, you know, we've been telling people when they were last on. I didn't actually pull the episode number because it was fairly recent.
John, it's a good thing I do actually have that.
Okay, you've got that. Good.
I do have that.
She was last on.
She was doing his homework.
She was on episode 2. John does a lot of homework. I'm just helping him right here.
Yeah, he's
okay?
just helping me.
She was last on episode 256, and we had her on because she's coming on a lot of the shows to talk about horror.
Yes.
And we went through the Scream franchise. And before we started recording, I was like looking at the date. May 26th of 2020. That's almost a year ago. Can you believe that?
Yeah.
It was during the pandemic for sure.
Yeah, absolutely.
One day we're going to do this in your basement again.
Yes.
One day.
I'm going to see your faces in real life.
Yeah.
That's going to be fun.
We're going to have a party that crazy far off the way things are going. I don't know about you folks, but I go in for my second shot at end of this week. So late May, I'll be a bit more sociable. So
I'm vaxxed.
We're all juiced
up. I'm also
up.
A hugger and a crier. So
I am too. I think we should just have an episode that's just
us crying. Yeah.
It's, you know, we've
easily doable.
Doing these Zoom episodes has been easy to do the video because we automatically have like a 3-camera shoot because we're in our different places. We've talked about when we're back in person again, how are we going to do a video episode that's not just one camera? But if it's one shot of the four of us just hugging and crying for an hour, that's easy to get on one camera.
It'll be like when you see couples sitting at the same side of the booth at a restaurant, we can shoot it like that.
Yeah. No, that's true. We'll be those people.
In a row, like a panel.
The four of us have to go get food and sit on one side of the table.
Of the booth. Yeah. Even if it's too small, we'll just squeeze in.
Just get there one by one. No, we're waiting on some people. No, we're all here now.
Make it real awkward.
Yeah. It's like the Last Supper, you know, that's how they
one
side of the table. All right. So Lauren, 10 years, we gave you the impossible question of trying to pick a favorite. I don't know. Are you good at picking favorites or do you always have to kind of make a list in your head? You know what your favorite is. You're good. Okay. Awesome. So favorite movie or TV show of the last 10 years then is?
Well, I wasn't told I could pick a TV show, but okay.
It's fine. You know, it helps you be decisive, but if you want to throw out a TV show, you can.
No, it's still the same answer. So it doesn't matter.
Hey, for the record, Lauren, everybody else basically has picked a movie. You know, people have mentioned TV shows, but
yeah
I admittedly didn't know. I wasn't sure of the TV show. So I told you movie.
All right. Wolf of Wall Street, obviously.
Nice.
I mean,
tell us why.
Well, Leo.
Beyond obvious.
Obviously, my, tell us my why he didn't win for that one, but he did win for that one where he had sex with
the
bear.
I don't know. I think it had everything for me. Like it's a Martin Scorsese, so there's that, and he directed probably my favorite movie ever. So, yeah, that was easy, and it's got Leo in it, and it's funny and a drama. I apparently like really long, drawn out crime. Story with comedic elements.
That's good. That's a good genre.
My heart. Besides horror, obviously.
Yeah.
So.
Have you watched it since you saw? How many times have you watched it?
Last night at 1:30 in the morning.
Did you finish it?
Like, let me just make sure this is definitely my favorite. Oh yeah, it is.
So you did a few lines and then you hopped on and watched Wolf of Wall Street.
Sure did.
Yeah. There you go.
Sure did, I mean, yeah.
There's that scene, that iconic scene where he's getting out to the car and he can't, you know, I mean, awesome. That I think about that all the time as like one of the funniest scenes I've ever I've ever
I kind of want to do those drugs a little bit.
It makes you wanna.
That would be like the shout along screening. It's like you do all the drugs they're doing on screen in Wolf of Wall Street.
Maybe when I'm like 80 and it doesn't matter anymore if I live or die. Yeah.
Do a bump every time they say penny stocks. You just
I just remember the that's my favorite part. But no, that is a great, great movie. And I feel like it's one of the Scorsese's of the recent wave of Scorsese where he's sort of saying, like, I want to remind people all the tricks, all the things, all the stuff they love about me. It's that you said it. It's super funny. It's really fast. It's a long movie, but it moves really fast.
It moves.
And there's so many comic moments in it on top of how kind of grim it is overall and how depressing it is to step back and realize people like this are real and they do succeed. And, you know.
Yeah.
So people criticize that movie for like glorifying Jordan Belfort. I never felt like that was the case at all. I felt like the movie all along, you know, he's kind of the villain of the piece. But
Mono, we're going to say.
I was going to say retroactive. I've shared this with you before. I know Steve likes to laugh at me about stuff like this. I went back and watched it and stop, Steve. Stop. I'm like, fucking stop. I went back and watched Wolf of Wall Street like really recently with my wife.
My wife.
Look at that. It's a really good movie.
Yeah.
Is it? I take back. I was really hard on it when I first saw it.
I remember you were, Ronald. I was upset with you.
It was because it just, I can be bougie about it a little bit sometimes. Like, when somebody's like, well, you know what movie I saw? Wolf of Wall Street was really good.
Is that supposed to be Lauren? Or
No, not Lauren at all. This, some of my
it was a weirdly
I'm
perfect
way more
impression.
Dramatic about it. I'm like, what are you talking about? I love that movie.
If I hadn't been looking at my screen, I would have thought that was Lauren. No,
yeah, if you close your eyes and like, whoa.
No, as I recall, Ronald, it was weird because you kind of went toe-to-toe with us about all the things we liked about the movie. But then your attitude was, damn, man, that sucked. And I'm always, that's funny that sometimes we have a thing where we just don't, it's like we're just not letting something in. And I'm not saying you were wrong to feel that way, but I do think it's odd when a movie just isn't scoring with you because for whatever reason, you're just not here for it, you know?
That's I think sometimes I get sick of seeing character studies about the same kind of people.
Yeah.
But it was done really well. It's just like, there's no denying how well that movie was done. It was a good movie. It was very entertaining. You know, Leonardo DiCaprio is a monster on screen. Like whenever I see him, I'm very happy. He makes me so happy. Even being a slave master, even whipping people. I'm like, man, I like that guy. I like that guy.
He's earned that from you, huh?
He's earned that, right?
It really is like one of the more entertaining, like, it's on my short list too. For context, Lauren, we haven't actually disclosed ours yet. We're doing it after all the guests are on the show. But like,
you're gonna tell me. I was gonna ask you.
You have to listen to the episode, Lauren.
Yeah, that's how I get you.
It's on my short list too because it is one of the ones like on the list. It's one of the most entertaining movies for sure that I feel like I've seen in the last 10 years, and mainly because of like the kind of modulating that it does between like the crime, the comedy, the con itself, and like just all the characters you come across in this company that he builds. And you know, you're talking also about just like an incredible cast, like kind of being introduced to Margot Robbie and, you know, Jonah Hill's there, Kyle Chandler's there, just like John Barenthal, just amazing cast. And that's no surprise when you think about, okay, Martin Scorsese is going to make a crime thriller, comedy, whatever you want to call this genre, like what you called it earlier. You know, everybody lines up to work with Martin Scorsese, but something about all of the pieces and where they were put in place in this movie really does feel like it clicked on all cylinders for me, for sure, the first time I saw it. And every time I've seen it since, but it really is Leo that just like John, I think he was saying it when you mentioned it, was like, how did he not win for that movie? But, you know, he's great in The Revenant, but how did he not win for this? Because this is like,
I mean, Matthew McConaughey.
This is peak Leo for sure.
Yeah.
But that was the reconnaissance, honestly. That was
You can't fight it.
I remember loving McConaughey in his brief moment in this too, because I think we were all kind of high on him and he had that speech that everybody kind of, you know, both loved and hated and everything. So I feel like if anybody was going to win instead of DiCaprio, it felt okay that it be McConaughey. But this movie really felt like the one where it was just undeniable. Was this where we were sitting there with the little DiCaprio heads?
The heads.
And, yeah, we were all there to celebrate. So, yeah.
Back when we used to watch the Oscars together. Well, yeah, Lauren actually,
watched
it together.
Year?
Yeah, we did.
Please, let's do.
We gotta have a party next year, man.
I'd love that.
The way things are going, they may tap us to host the Oscars next year. So let's just see how that goes.
We've submitted our tape to the Academy.
This is actually it. We're submitting this episode.
This is it. I got it.
So we're hoping that that quilted headboard helps us seem kind of classy, and that we might get, you know.
I got real excited when I saw it, because like that's gonna push us over. Like these guys are like fancy as shit. Yeah. So
fancy schmancy.
I'll buy a gown.
Yeah.
I'll buy a gown.
I will too.
Nice.
Do it.
Yeah. Pick.
Yeah, that's it. Well, that's a great one. I mean, honestly, I feel like that's one that I didn't think of until late when I was like looking at movies of the last few years, and it definitely was. It made it onto my short list too, just of one that I thought if you were going to single one out, I would even say that like the sort of like you said, Ronald, you've seen so many movies about dirtbags that maybe you get a little distance from it. This movie is about a particular kind of dirtbag who I think now we can look back and say with a little more historical like perspective that like a big problem like that that are a big reason why we're in the kind of fucked up situation that we're in right now, you know, financially and stuff, and why a lot of people are struggling. So no, that is you kind of wonder, like we've talked about that before, are we going to get tired of anti-heroes and watching stories about gross people? But I feel like what Scorsese does is make it so entertaining that you it almost tricks you into like lusting after their life or something. I don't know. It's a little game that they play, but he did that in Goodfellas too. He kind of made you think, well, this seems like it would be kind of cool to be one of these guys.
Even though
you can totally see how disturbing it is. So
Lauren, thank you so much for coming on the podcast.
Thank you. Welcome.
Yes. And we'll have you back again soon, but probably to talk about something horror related. What's the next big horror thing?
Something bloody.
Yeah, there you go.
New Candyman's coming. New
Quiet Place 2.
Coming. Yeah. Quiet Place 2.
When's Quiet Place coming out now?
End of May.
Oh, it's in May.
As this comes out, it would probably be like in 2 weeks or a week. Okay. Yeah.
Even I had a thought about The Quiet Place. Did you talk to them about it yet, or do I have to be making you put you on the spot?
I don't think I have yet. I think we've talked about the idea of renting a theater and possibly, you know, that being the way to see a movie with people you know, are vaccinated and the safest possible scenario. So we'll table that. We'll see.
Yeah. No, it's a good idea.
Yeah.
Crickets.
No, I'm
insert sound effect, John, post-production. Note.
I'm down.
And Ronald, can you put in like, since you're doing the video part, can you put in like actual like crickets, like CGI crickets
jumping around the screen?
Absolutely.
Actually, just replace Lauren with a cricket.
Don't do that.
Please.
Don't do that.
It's like, anyway.
You like poor Deb in Nightmare on Elm Street 4.
Yeah, right.
Oh, God.
Please don't.
Okay, we wouldn't do that. Not to our. I'll say it. Everyone else on the show, suck it. Our favorite guest.
Yeah. The most. What would you call? I always think of it like SNL. Like I'm hosting. Like I've been the most visiting guest of Movie Shmoovie.
Yeah, you're like the
most prominent
Five Timers Club that they had on there. Where it was.
Yeah,
like
I need a jacket, like a memorable jacket. Something.
We'll get that ordered for you.
Yeah.
All right.
Cool.
Thanks.
Cool.
Friend.
Do you want your name on the back, or is there like a cool nickname you want emblazoned on the back?
You know what? I'll let you guys honor me in whatever way you feel is appropriate.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool.
So it better be good, implied.
Don't fuck it up.
Yeah. All right. Well, we'll see you soon, Lauren. Thanks so much for making time.
Thanks, Lauren.
And all the
appearances.
Love you.
I'm like technologically, should I just hit leave?
You just lay the phone down. Just lay it down.
All right, guys. I'll see you later.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
And there she went.
So good.
And there she went. And then there were three. Just us. No more Zoom calls to wait for.
There it is, guys.
That was fun.
Yeah.
So that's it, right? We don't have anything else to cover. This is the end of the episode. It was a pleasure.
That's it, guys.
See you around. Wait a minute.
That's where you put the record scratch.
Yeah.
We'll use it a couple times.
Yeah.
We got to talk about our picks. Did either of you have a particularly hard time with this, or did something like jump to your mind and you kind of stuck with it? Because for me, it was almost like an easy choice, but I did run that choice up against as many things as I could possibly find. But there was one movie and one show. And I honestly, I still in the back of my mind, I don't know which one I'm putting as the top.
Yeah.
But I'm down to one movie and one show that is easy for me to say I feel good about. What about you guys?
It was. So I'm trying to commit. I'm struggling right now, even speaking with you guys about it. I'm trying to go with the first thing that came to my mind, because I feel like it made the it, it the impression that it made was so great that it's the first thing I thought of. And it may surprise you guys. I don't know, maybe not. But I did do a bit of due diligence in, like, you know, I'm very particular, very anal every year doing the top 10 list. I keep collections on my Plex server for every year's top 10 list. So I did go back and, like, kind of browse the last 10 years to make sure that I was considering everything and did what you said, John, like kind of putting a couple things on the list. And I did make like a list, like a 10 list of the decade. And, you know, and still it kind of kept rising to the top, mainly because of the way I felt walking out of the theater and also just like the prominence that this movie has in conversations that I have. But yeah, I don't know. It definitely was like a gut check for me. And it was like, I'm going to go with my first instinct. What about you, Ronald?
Yeah. I mean, mine is sentimental. It's connected to us. And then I've watched this movie definitely over 10 times, hands down. It is distinctly, it kept popping up in my mind. And yeah, it's been in my head since we first had the conversation. And
you know, we didn't do our top 10 of the year this year. I feel like it's been a while since we've had this weird sweaty feeling of like, yeah. So my pick is, I feel pretty good about it, but it's like, there's a certain kind of don't get this wrong feeling, which of course is absurd, right? Because we can come back on our very next episode and say, you know what else is good? And it's got equal
weight. It erases everything.
But I've kind of the same thing. I'll just double back and say, this is one that I have never, in the several years since I've seen it, I have never come up with a reason why I wouldn't name it as my favorite movie of the last 10 years, you know, and I think that's a big thing. So who wants to throw one out? Do you guys have a feeling about what the other ones? I really don't have a feeling about what you guys would say. I thought about it and I was like, you seem like you might be just as likely to pull something small that really stayed with you as you would be to point to something that you were just awed by in the moment of seeing it.
Right.
It's tough to know. I don't know. Do you have a feeling about what the rest of us might say?
Small. I have a hunch.
Yeah.
I think
mentally note that hunch so you can say, I got it. You know, you can say, gotcha. I know you.
Yeah. Gotcha.
Yeah.
John, why don't you start, man? Why don't you kick it off?
All right. So I'm not going to rose you by picking more than one thing.
Episode 300 marks the change from being Walker to being rosed.
I might say that if I were to pick the TV show that I would have named, it'd be very easy to dig into my past recommendations and podcasts I may have put out and determine what it might have been. But 2016, written and directed by a person already mentioned, the one and only Taika Waititi, Hunt for the Wilder People, is one of those movies. I want to call it a perfect movie. I heard someone say a while back, a perfect movie is not a movie without flaws. It's a movie whose flaws you're willing to look past to appreciate everything else about it. And I really feel like whatever you might point to about this movie, you know, little rhythmic tonal things, I've seen people hang in there with it. I've seen people only thought it was okay, but I feel like it's so true and it's got so much heart and it's got so much humor and it's an adventure and it's got this great cast. And it has even a song that sticks with me that is like original to the movie, the Ricky Baker Happy Birthday song. It's even got a great director cameo in a very funny scene. It's like, I went to go see this movie with my son when he was, 2016 it came out. So that would have been, so he was like nine or 10. This was like an early kind of hard PG-13 sort of experience for him in the movie theater. And it was also maybe the first time I went to take him to something that was not a big animated movie or a big summer movie type movie. This was a little bit for him, kind of a grown-up movie, so to speak, or a coming of age movie or something. And he loved the shit out of it. And
that's,
it was so fun, so exciting, so great. That was actually like shortly before he and I went on a road trip together. And it just had this feeling of like, I was so glad we saw that movie before we went on that trip, because it totally put us in that mindset. And he was, you know, I don't know. So I have a lot of personal feelings towards it for that reason. But all the things I said about why it's good, it just is one of those movies. I kind of feel like it's one of those movies you can recommend to someone and almost bank on them enjoying it. Like, I don't know. I mean, maybe I'm wrong, but I just think it's like it's got heart and warmth and positivity, and you care about the characters. And it's got that YTT humor. So yeah. I mean, I kind of want to finish this podcast and go watch it again right now.
I know, right? It's such a feel good movie.
Yeah. So that's it. Crickets.
Great pick, John.
I love that movie. Taika Waititi is legitimately one of my favorite creators. One of the best TED Talks I've ever seen in my human existence.
Great fashion sense.
He's amazing.
Yeah, great fashion sense. So yeah, I agree with that.
That's one of the good ones.
Mm-hmm. He is.
In every
he
sense is. Of the word.
He is.
Yeah.
And he keeps making things that make me reevaluate what I know. Like, I'm like, okay, I saw the preview for Thor Ragnarok. I'm like, okay, this can't be that different than anything I've ever watched. And then you watch it and it's totally different. It has his sensibility. So yeah, I like that. My pick is like a emotional pick, but also like something that fucked my world up. Steve and I went to a screener downtown to see a movie called Drive. Had no idea anything about it. It was just a poster. It felt like Fast and the Furious. In fact, somebody sued because they thought that it was supposed to be like Fast and the Furious. Sued the studio, and I watched it, and it messed me up. Like it did a couple of things. Like right around that time, I'd started doing stand up pretty heavily, right? And when I first started, I was very fast. I was like, blah, 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 blah. All right, bye. And I'd leave, right? And I remember somebody said to me, you gotta let stuff breathe. I didn't understand what that meant until I saw somebody that took their time on stage. And this movie did it in a way that was like it right in the same time that I was trying to develop an idea of kind of letting things breathe, being in the moment. And Drive told a story that didn't have a ton of words in it, that did more showing than telling. And I thought that was so incredible. And the soundtrack is out of this world. I still listen to the soundtrack. Every couple weeks, I still listen to A Real Hero, one of the main songs from the soundtrack. So Drive and the experience of seeing it with you had a pretty profound effect on my life. And
And I would add, for seeing that movie with you, I can attest, like, I feel like I look a little bit more into some of these movies than you do when we go see them, like in terms of like production and who's it about, whatever.
Right, right, right.
So like that was a really amazing movie to see with you, because that was right at the beginning of this podcast starting. That was early days. And it was a situation where there was like us and like maybe two other people. Like there was not many people there in a small theater downtown. And I do vividly recall you just coming out of that movie, just really like trying to understand like how you like felt about it in a positive way.
Yeah.
Like, cause you went in like, yeah, I'll come with you. Like, let's go check it out. And you just completely were just like, I don't even, just struck by it. Like you were talking about it nonstop. And even that episode of the podcast, in an earlier one of Movie Shmovie, I don't know which one it is specifically, but we talk about it. You know, go back and listen to that, and like how just like passionate you were about that then is just like, it's cool to hear you say that.
Yeah.
Yeah, Drive, man.
Have you watched it recently?
I watched it like right before the I always watch the first scene. So like I watch the first scene pretty consistently. Like every couple months I watch it. The whole movie I haven't watched in a while. Not because it's a bad movie, but because like, you know, some of the parts that happen always make me sad.
Yeah, yeah. Some of it's hard to watch.
Some of it's hard to watch.
I think it's fun to watch Oscar Isaac in that movie now.
That's what I'm getting at. It's like the people kind of forget the cast of that movie. Like you have Bryan Cranston, you have Oscar Isaac, Albert Brooks is amazing.
Albert Brooks, like in some ways, is like the revelation of the movie in a way.
He really is. And Christina Hendricks, like everybody in the movie, Ron Perlman, it's just like, it gets lost how great the cast is, or at least forgotten, overshadowed by other things about the movie. But yeah, man, Drive is amazing. Great pick. I wish I felt the same about his movies past Drive. And the one thing his podcast has told us.
Only God Forgives. People should go back and find the Only God Forgives episode, because that was,
it's an all-timer, guys. Yeah. It's an all-timer. The Steve pod, not mad. The movie.
Steve came in hot.
I was very upset. And you know why, though, man? Because you come off something like Drive and like Ronald's describing and that experience with him. And I loved it just as much as he's saying.
Yeah.
And that was just not the movie I wanted to see. But great pick, man.
There's this line from one of my favorite shows of all time, Bored to Death, on HBO. And one of the characters says, "We enthrall and we disappoint." And that describes Nicholas Winding Refn like to a T. He enthralled us with this movie, and he has been disappointing us ever since. It sucks, man. It sucks. I want to finish his Amazon show. That was also very crazy.
Which one is that?
The
with Miles Teller.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I never watched that.
It is gorgeous.
And I've heard that. And most of his movies are.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Most of his movies are.
Miles Teller enthralled and then disappointed too. So they're a good
they paired up nicely.
They're a good pair. All right, Steve, let's hear it.
So, guys, the first movie that comes to my mind, if I think about, so I'm gonna lead up a little bit. The past decade.
Take us back.
The past decade, if I'm being honest with myself, thinking about filmmakers, thinking about directors, we talk a lot about filmmakers on this podcast and what they mean to us and the impact that they make and the kind of possibly even being in early days of a filmmaker that will go down as being one of the greatest, possibly, depending how the rest of his career plays out. You know, I'm a huge fan of Spielberg, Scorsese. We all love these filmmakers.
Right.
But there's a filmmaker that came in my sight in 2013 and made a movie called Prisoners. And Denis Villeneuve has slowly and steadily become one of my favorite filmmakers of the past decade. If I look at my list that we keep talking about, there's four of his films are like in conversation in 10 years as being possibly one of my favorite movies of the last decade. You know, he's made Sicario, which we've all loved. He's made Arrival, which is probably one of the movies that gave my choice the biggest run for its money. And even Blade Runner 2049, however you feel about it, I love that movie. But the first conversation we had about best movie of the decade, the first movie that came to my mind was 2013's Prisoners. And it was my first introduction to him. I went back and saw his Incendiaries film once I saw Prisoners. But this movie blew me away when I saw it. I had such an emotional reaction to this movie. And I'm not talking Endgame reaction. I'm not talking rooting, excitement. You know, that kind of emotion. You're talking about a movie where two girls get kidnapped and the parents and the desperation and the sacrifice that they're basically trying to go through to find these kids. And you cast some of my favorite actors. You cast Hugh Jackman, you cast Jake Gyllenhaal, you cast Viola Davis, who has gone on to be one of the best actresses of the last decade in this movie. People forget she's in this and she's phenomenal in the movie in a smaller role. You have Paul Dano, you have Melissa Leo, you have David Mastucci, how do you say his last name? Mastuccian?
It's like, is it that, like that, that's Mouchane or something?
Yeah, that's Mouchane.
I know.
You know the guy. He's
we'll
in
learn
the
by our next
squad.
Episode, but yeah. by episode 301, we'll be pronouncing his name properly. But he's a great character actor. He's one of those ultimate that guys.
I always try to say it right, and I even follow him, and I've heard him say it. It's like Dasmuchian or something like that. Anyway, right. he's also in it.
Yeah.
The bottom line is the movie has a great cast. We talk about casting in Drive and, you know, it's an ensemble. But really, like, it comes down to Gyllenhaal. It comes down to Hugh Jackman. And it comes down to Paul Dano. And there are layers of this movie that just slowly peel away the characterization of these parents, of these fathers, which I was not one at the time. And, you know, my brother had a son by that point, and Lauren and Brian were actually at the point of trying to have a child at first. And, you know, the context of a child to me, like, obviously I understood the weight of it, but I could not relate to it. So in years since that, when I've seen this movie, which it's kind of weird, I don't know what it says about me that I've watched this movie multiple times, because it is a very hard movie to watch.
No, I me too. It's so satisfying. It's so good. It's just like,
it really is. And there's some just amazing scenes in the movie, you know, like the bathroom scene with Hugh Jackman and Paul Dano, where he's basically torturing this guy, his commitment to who he thinks is responsible for this kidnapping. And, you know, I don't know, just the characterization, the way that it tears apart a person, their connections to the people that they love the most, and ultimately, like, how you can kind of come to terms or you know, feel about the possibility of never seeing your child again. Which in years since has obviously changed my world, having two kids now. And even when I had my daughter, like, or when we had our daughter, like, watching the movie after she was born, like, completely rocked me in a different way. So, you know, this movie is something that always comes up when I talk about some of my favorite movies ever. I would even say it's in the conversation forever for me, not even just decade, because it just seems like a perfect storm. And it's also that idea of like, this is the first movie that I saw from Denis. And I do think he is a filmmaker that has one of the most consistent track records of mainstream releases, and also just like of the past decade from when this podcast has been around. So, and we've represented him very well, you know, in the years that his movies are released, you know, for Prisoners, Arrival, and Sicario, those three movies were number one for me in their respective years. And Blade Runner 2049 was still in my top 10. It's just nothing comes close to that filmmaker for the decade. And honestly, for movies, I really, as much as I love movies, like some of our guests have said, Get Out is a movie that came to mind. Endgame, obviously, we've talked about tons on this podcast. And even like Wolf of Wall Street, everything that's been talked about have been such amazing movies and definitely popped in my mind. But there has not been a movie this decade that has completely just shook me like Prisoners did when I first saw it. And even the closing shot with the way the movie stops and you just really don't know how it ends. You have feelings about how you think it ends. And I just think it's a powerhouse movie with great performances all around. Also shot by Roger Deakins, who frequently works with Villeneuve, nominated for an Oscar for cinematography, didn't win, but just a perfect movie in my eyes. And definitely my pick for the best movie that this podcast has been around. So last decade.
Well, it's the schmovie era of movies. Yeah. Now I just want to tell you, I love our top three.
Our top three is amazing.
Great. Okay.
So it is the best representation of this podcast, I think.
Yeah.
Like it is perfect.
I mean, even though Vinding Refn didn't necessarily turn out to be one of our guys in that sense, Drive as a movie really does mark this era of movies in a way that's really interesting. And the style, and even Ryan Gosling. Like there's so many aspects of that movie that have kind of become viral in a sense since that.
An iconic
movie. Yeah. And it's a lot to do with style, and it's a lot to do with vision. And it is. I mean, he may be the kind of director who will really impress us again someday.
And
then you add to that the a YTT pick and a Villeneuve pick. I mean, it couldn't be more schmoovy. We gave you guys this is one of the best episodes of Movie Schmoovy ever. I think
it's one of the most schmooviest episodes for sure.
Yes,
absolutely.
And it's pretty movie. It's movie-ish and schmoovy-ish. This episode, I hope
it's a perfect amount of movie, but an excessive amount of schmoovy.
Right, which I think is kind of our guarantee.
That's what you guys want, so we gave it to you.
Yeah. Well, this has been awesome. I mean, I don't just mean this episode. Time, I mean, this time. I've always been a movie nut. I remember sitting in the back of the Apple store hearing that you guys had a podcast and hearing you guys talk about it and kind of being jealous in a weird way of like, oh, that sounds like so much fun, you know, because I was more than anybody I knew at that point. I was into podcasts and I listened to them.
Yeah.
And I knew how much fun that could be at like a conversation show where everybody sort of shows up having done their homework and ready to have a real conversation, not just about the movie, but about the culture around it and the story behind it. I can't think of anyone else I would trust necessarily. I mean, there's a very short list of people and most of them have been on this episode that I also think take it that seriously and would approach an episode of this with the same like lightness. Like we come in not knowing what we're going to laugh about, but we really try to know our shit and try to fill in the holes that the other guys might leave open and stuff. And I just think like Brandon earlier was talking about a band.
Yeah.
This is a band.
It really is.
And we've kept the band together for 10 years. So, I mean, that's not nothing. That's not nothing, guys.
Yeah, man. Good times. Good times. Let's keep it going for another 300.
Yeah.
Let's do it.
We've guaranteed we'll at least go through 350. We've discussed that on episode 175, someone said that we might be halfway done. And now the fact that that's actually in reach, we're going to have to actually decide what happens.
It's all canon, John. So it's got to happen. 350.
So the countdown begins now. Will Movie Schmovie do 50 more episodes, or will they break their promise and make more?
That's when they all unsubscribe, the seven people. They're like, fuck this.
It's like, fuck these guys. I'm out. I can't trust them anymore.
They didn't tell me the truth.
Damn liars.
That'd be like finding out the guys on Mount Rushmore were racist assholes.
What a thought.
Oh, man. I'm happy that we were able to achieve this, man.
Good times. It does. This last week, I've been like listening. I went back and like grabbed a couple. I listened to like 15 episodes of like the first 10 of us and like the first 5 or 10 of or 6 of when John joined. And it's just crazy, man. Like I have vivid memories of like recording stuff, like at, the first time we went to John's, and like, even going into your house, Ronald, and sitting on chairs that were like about to fall apart, and like little like pop-up chairs, and just coming over to my house. Like I lived with my parents still, as you did, but like just in my bedroom, just sitting up there, just recording for not really knowing what we were doing, but just literally talking. And that's been the joy of this podcast, is just like, it's a lot more streamlined now. And this year has definitely taught us a lot about how to be efficient with our time and with this podcast time.
And how much we value it, and how much it's like,
absolutely. Absolutely.
That I even my wife, as much as I joke about her going, oh boy, he's talking about movies again. Like, she totally gives me space for this. She knows how sane it keeps me. And she loves you guys too. So
she's great. good run, guys. Let's keep it going. Again, thank you to all the guests that came back to spend a little bit of time with us. We love you guys. We thank you all for the time you spent with us over the 10 years, but especially the time you brought back today to kind of hang out and kind of go over what you remembered and you picked as your pick for number one of the last 10 years. But that's just like a, you know, motivation to get them all back on the podcast in the next year. Hopefully they'll make it into one of those 50 that we have left. Fingers crossed, guys.
Yeah, I know.
Fingers crossed. Seriously. What do you guys have, anything else you want to add, or are we good, or what's up?
No, I think that's I'm good, man. I think that's it for the last 10 years.
That's it. Yeah. We'll just wrap it up with a www.movieschmovie.com, guys. .com. Follow us there. You can go there and find any podcast platform you want, and we're there. We've managed to do that over 10 years to get on every platform, basically. Yeah, no, literally. I think we are there. We've done that.
Yeah. Yeah,
and we've got a nice little site where you can go and find us. We're on Facebook, all the social medias, .com/movieschmovie. Find the YouTube channel, which is where this video, if you're watching, thank you. Subscribe, hit the bell so you get alerts when these episodes come out, if you'd rather watch them on YouTube, or the special series that we do called Marvel Schmarvel that just started a couple months ago that we'll keep doing as Marvel keeps putting stuff out, which won't stop ever. So that'll keep going. And, you know, for 10 years, you guys, you've made our day. Thanks.
Bye. You've made our decade, you could also say.
of every day.
Yes,
of you've made decade. Every day of it. You've done it. You've literally.
All right.
Man, that was awesome.
Yeah.
That was really fun.
Stop and save and then say, oh my gosh, we did what we said we'd do.
Yep. And yeah, dude, that was awesome. That was good seeing it from everybody. Yeah. And it went off pretty much without a hitch.
And I love that nobody's picks got doubled or anything, you know. Yeah. Even Bob's list, I started to get afraid of his list.
I was a little worried when he had five.
Yeah, but I love that none of them, well, they were all cool choices for him, you know what I mean, like none of them were super obvious on the nose for him.
So that was
a good list. But anyway,
except for maybe Bob, Thor, that was obvious.
Yeah, right. Yeah, that was a gimme. Maybe so there's two Waititis. So I guess he's the winner of the
Schmovie
the decade.
So that was a time when we go to movie screeners. I'd see him there. I'd see him at stand up on Mondays. I saw Bob a lot, and then I saw him. I didn't see him at all. So like, I got really used to laughing with him and joking with him outside of Jesus, man.
Well, admittedly, like me, like I feel like because half the time I was going to the movie screenings, I was like working them. I didn't have as much time, like, you know, when you sit down and you're chit-chatting with Bob or whoever else that we would catch up with at screenings, like I kind of missed some of those opportunities, but thankfully, like, we do live near one another. So like I would see him out at breakfast sometimes at this spot that we both go to locally. So we'd catch up there and actually have a conversation beyond a moment. So that was always nice to see him, but haven't seen him, you know, forever. But thankfully, whenever we get back to movies, like, you know, because we can still go to the Allied stuff because we're like legit now with them. We'll be able to go there and just kind of hang out and see people that we haven't seen and have conversations like that. And I look forward to like being able to just talk after screening with people about what they thought of it, just not having to work it, you know. Like,
I have a feeling the first time it happens, we're all going to kind of, you know how there's like you standing out in the hall kind of milling around. I think we're all just going to be walking up to each other going,
it happened.
But like, we're here, you know. It's like, I don't know whether to say, oh my god, how are you, and hug you, or whether to say, I didn't like that ending, you know, or whatever. It's like, but it'll be nice to get back to that feeling normal again, if it ever quite is the same. But I thought about that recently, just bumping into people at that type of event. It's like, that used to be a big part of your social existence, was just the people you ran into.
Yeah.
And now you have to seek those people out if you want to check on them. And I've been trying to do that as much as possible. Like, if I realize I haven't seen someone, I'm like, oh shit, maybe this is when you check in on someone and just say, how's it going? Still, you know, there's people that you've almost forgotten about who aren't on your social media, but that you just, you're used to seeing them, you know? So no, it's going to be exciting, whatever it is. And I like that idea of some kind of special renting a theater, whatever. I mean, we can we'll find the right movie and the right time and the right everything for it. But that's a good idea.
Well, here's what I was going to say. Like I was just over Lawrence yesterday. We were talking about it yesterday, so I didn't really bring it up. We talked about like the whole renting thing before on the podcast, but like Quiet Place 2 comes out like Memorial Day weekend is like that Friday. So like the 5th or 28th or something like that. But I mean, I don't know, like just to put it out there, we were trying to figure out like what we could do to kind of get back to see a movie. And like, that's one that we all, I'm sure, want to see, you know, badly, especially in a theater. Like that's one of the ones you say like, man, that first one was amazing seeing it in a theater. But, you know, if it comes out at the end of May, that's, you know, a month still. And, you know, if everybody's vaccinated, which it sounds like everybody will be, I mean, if you guys are open to it or interested at all, like, you know, we talked about, because like when you rent them out, like for first run stuff, you know, like I think they only, I don't know if they rent them out on the weekends still, but like, it's like weekdays at certain AMCs. But whenever it is the window, like if there's something that's possible for everybody to go to, you know, basically I think for that movie, it would be $250 to rent a theater. But if there was like 10 of us going, you know, of this small group, you're talking, that's not that much money. I mean, if you guys want to do it so that it's like contained and safe and we're as much of a bubble as still as we possibly can be, but still doing something that we haven't done in over a year. Mm-hmm. You know, if you're interested, I would love it if you would want to do it with us. I mean, we definitely want to try to keep it small, not get too crazy, but I think because you can have up to 20 when you rent it. So in a theater that holds like 125 or whatever they hold now, I think those rentals, you're capped at 20 people, at least now. Okay. That might change by the time it comes out. I don't know. But right now, when I tried to book it the other night, it was 20 people. So, I mean, you know, there's already 8 or 10 of us there, depending on, you know, what we do. But we could, you know, if there's somebody else that you think that would want to participate or pitch into it that is fully vaccinated, like definitely I'm open to that too.
Okay.
Yeah,
man, I'm down.
No, I'm up for it. I mean, yeah, like I think Nikki would be too. It's too bad Henry wouldn't technically be vaccinated, but we can find some.
I mean, if you want him to come, John, I'd be fine with that. Especially,
but I mean, definitely we'll keep that conversation open, you know, because
if you want to bring Henry, I mean, I know he doesn't have the option to do that, but if all the adults are and like we still are smart and like distance and how we sit and mm-hmm. things like that and just be smart about it. We can make it work for sure.
You guys can see how tall he is. You got to see.
I can't. Like, I've seen your. I saw the one picture you posted. Like, it's kind of crazy how really different is. He looks.
It's weird hanging out with a young man. Like, he's not there yet, but you start to sense that.
It's
like,
coming, man. It's almost there.
Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah.
Yeah, man.
I'll ask you guys. Like, I'll look into it over the next couple of weeks. But again, I don't know if they'd let you do it opening weekend because I guess that's probably where they're making the money.
Right.
But I mean, like the weeknights for sure. I know. Between either White Marsh or the AMC one here in Owings Mills, like those are the two that I think are doing the bookings where you can still get like the first run movies when they come out. But I have to see which one has it. But I don't know, you know, if we had 20 people, it'd be cheaper than a freaking movie ticket normally is. So, you know, that it'd be like $11 or something like that a person, but we can talk about it again soon.
No, definitely.
That's the idea.
It sounds like a good, the right group to do it with too, in my opinion.
Yeah.
So
yeah, for sure.
All right.
Cool, man.
Yeah. No, I'm sort of like, I want to, until I see the audio, I won't know, but I feel like this worked.
It did.
And, it came off. And honestly,
hopefully you don't have a problem editing that intro stuff out, but like the video, I guess, to move it to the front.
That'd be perfect. That'll be perfect, man. Like,
okay.
With the time, I thought you meant like to get it all done, but I forgot.
Yeah. No, it's like 3 weeks.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. So yeah. So,
we've got 98 this Wednesday, 99 the next Wednesday. And then this is like 2.5 weeks out.
Yeah. So the it'll come out on the 21st of May, Ronald.
Okay.
So that week we won't record because we already have it, but you know, we can, you know, if there's anything that needs to be done, any pickup stuff.
Yeah.
I forgot to tell you guys like 30. So I have to probably edit it fairly soon.
Yeah,
the 31st, I'm going to North Carolina. My mom is doing like this secret wedding thing.
The week, May 31st.
Yeah,
the week
so
of.
I'm gonna be gone.
I'm gone in mid June, too. But I mean, that's so far out that I didn't really mention. But it's like
I think we're trying to leave the 27th and come back the 2nd. So I may miss. I can do the 26th.
We could record that week that we're not putting something out because we have this done, and then have it for the next week when Ronald's out of town.
Yeah, we can figure that out. So I just have to. Yeah, she's like, she called me the other day and said, like, we're getting married in North Carolina. And I'm like, oh, shit. I had no idea. She's like, it's a little crazy, but.
Well, let's get all of our dates for the next little bit straightened out so that we can kind of know what those are.
So, yeah, I'm trying to think. So that'll come out the 21st. Because I'm thinking about those embargo dates that we have for MODOK and for, what you call it, the profile movie.
Yeah.
Because one's the 14th, so that would come out. We could do the profile the week of the 14th. Mm-hmm. The MODOK is the embargo is the Monday. The Monday the 17th is the embargo. Oh,
okay.
So yeah, the 21st episode, the episode for the 21st would be that one. Mm. I mean, so we can do those. I mean, that's 2 weeks, and then you know this coming week. I don't know. We can figure something out, but
yeah.
Did you guys watch the Mitchells versus the Machines?
Not yet.
Holy shit. It is amazing.
No. I can't wait to see. I mean, it's like, I can't believe that it's,
I'll say I'm saying that we should talk about that this week for sure.
Okay, let's do it.
Because
do it.
That seems like that can at least give us a foundation for the next 3 weeks. And then, you know, I don't know, man. Yeah. That's, no, I guess MODOK would come out the week after because the 21st would be the 300th episode.
Well, if we did it as a Marvel Schmarvel, then it could be like 22nd. I was thinking for one of the Marvel Schmarvels, if we wanted to have it be in the audio feed too, just to sort of give people a taste. So maybe for that, we can do it as an episode of Marvel Schmarvel, but drop it in the audio feed and say like, hey, if you're just listening to the audio, this is what Marvel Schmarvel is, you know, because it's a way for us to keep that consistency going. But also I feel like I've thought like we would drop any like certain movies, I picture us dropping back into the regular feed too if there's something huge comes out that, you know, we would talk about
on the
show. But either way, I feel like if we just plan it out, there's three or four things we can record in whatever order we want to that we can have out on the date that like the embargo's up, or we can just have it like,
yeah, we'll figure it out. But so yeah, the week that you're away, Ronald, we'll the week of this one or whatever, we'll just bank it. Like we'll just do something and bank it the week before.
That sounds good.
So there's no rush when you get back to do anything.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right, man. All right, John, you're still recording. I don't know if you know that or not.
Yeah, no, I'm about to stop it. Okay. I'm going to stop it and hit save. And then I'm going to sit here and do this until. Yeah. Did you ever, when you're growing
that
up,
should be the shot that, yeah, everybody do this. All right, that'll be the screenshot. So make sure we get that cap. Yeah. If you can get that.
All right. Well, this has been awesome. And we'll obviously be talking soon.
Okay.
Talk to you guys.
Love you guys.
All right,
bye.
Guys. See you guys.